when it was Kemet, Black Egypt. It was a Nile Valley civil, Black Egypt. Like and subscribe, Black Egypt. It wasn't no Mediterranean culture, like and subscribe. You gon' get tormented for 4 minutes if this war win it. Just said, Jesseru got a false door in it. The Nubian flow, that's before Kemet. My Sakim key got rubies and gold. And it's fit for a Kushite king, but what it look like? The green Sahara ring bearer bring terror to your satellite kingdom, so they do not bother me. Scarification look like wavy line pottery. Kush with the black top pots. I rap top notch, and I could kick you till your laptop stops. I'm like Tahaka, Shabaka, or Bianchi, the author's a father. Any cocky, I came down to now through the lands of Kush, living a pre-dynastic Pharaoh way in Marrow way. Kerma, Khartoum, or Semna by the fifth cataract. Now I put the fifth wheel on the Cadillac. So much ride, a white man couldn't battle that though, they had to paddle back. Black Egypt, Black Egypt, Black Egypt.
Gotta look and see where the Nile started.
Black Egypt,
how it's easier to go downstream than upstream.
Black Egypt. What you know about Dynasty 00? Roll through with Shimsu Heiru on the standard. Ta-Nehisi, Sudanese G's. Try to test me. I'm an archer from Ta Seti. The squad ready, so I'm stepping in with the extra thin leopard skin. A tail on the apron with my crown on. You can crack jokes, but I ain't the one to clown on. Ayo, Egypt was black, and that's a fact. All you little suckers need to step on back. They tried to throw us off, but we kept on track. We started doing research once you slept on that. And with Kemet, it don't matter what the name means. If it's a black culture, then that's the same thing. Race science is a lame thing. Ever since Nubian times, I let the chain swing. How the first known of Egypt was Ta Seti. But Ta Seti was Ta Seti already. Yep, it meant the land of the bow. And when Egyptians needed archers, this is where they would go to recruit them. I got arrows and I'll shoot them. Who them fake pharaohs? I uproot them and usurp them. Black Egypt. 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 Black Egypt.
That white crown, upper age, boy.
Come on.
Babylonian bars, Ugaritic spit it, get it, dagger on me. That harpoon, it ain't for abalone. Phoenician pieces made of Nubian gold. Antediluvian scrolls hit the Nubian poles. And if you wanna debate that, you'll get truly exposed. I'm like the king of Axum, Axum. Bring the maxims of Ptah back to action. I actually swing my axe, so Y axis, 32 degrees west on the Y axis. Try and catch us. Christianity was stole from Kemet, lying bastards. Compare the Book of Psalms to Amenope. Sometimes I'm rhyming, I'm just like a shaman, okay?
I rock the white crown,
say Tashima.
You rock the red crown,
say Tameho.
You rock the white crown,
say Tashima.
You rock the red crown,
say Tameho. I'm a star charting Bantu boy with my bow and arrow. I raise a king in my gnome if I don't know the pharaoh. Explosive and lethal in your dreams like Joseph the Hebrew. And no sending evil, why jet and neck bent? Here to ward that off, I'm not a sage burner. Scroll learner, the page turner. The script writer, put the pen down, cause I don't fucking need it. Cause I got the white crown, the upper
I rock
Egypt.
The white crown, say Tashimbu. You rock the red crown,
say Tameho.
You rock the white crown,
say Tashimbu.
You rock the red crown,
say top man. Rah, I'm a C group, Magi Archer, from Ta-Nehisi. You conscious community pseudos never try to test me. Cause I'm in Rock Squad up, fuck religion. And when I'm on the mic, don't cut my wisdom, boy. I'm W.E.B. Du Bois. I'll smother you under the Sphinx, heed the voice. Ancestrally cooking up mean lyrics. Cats fighting cause they don't think the Dogon has seen Cirrus. And DNA can't prove ethnicity. How you conscious? You say Pacific instead of specifically. You know my shit so raw, you get crushed. Think the force of a hippo jaw. It's the magic.
Say Tashimbu. you rock the red crown.
Say top mecca, you rock the white crown.
Say top shimmer, you rock the red crown.
Say top mecca,
I rock the white crown.
Say top shimmer,
you rock the red crown.
Say top mecca,
you rock the white crown.
Say top shimmer, you rock the red crown.
Say top mecca.
Yo, yo, what up, what up? Yo, checking in the child seat, man himself. We gotta let the people roll in the house. We gonna chill for a minute. Let the people roll in the house. Let me see. Close that door, puppy. What's up with it? I'm about to get it popping, but I'm not about to rush. Want to allow some people to get the notification of the stream. You know, they trying to, Yup. We're going to bring that back on them one time.
When it was Kemet, Black Egypt. It was a Nile Valley Civil Black Egypt.
Like and subscribe.
Black Egypt.
It wasn't no Mediterranean culture.
Like and subscribe. Bring it back.
You gonna get tormented for 4 minutes if it's war when it just said Jester Rue got a false door in it. The Nubian
like
flow.
The
that's before Kemet. My son Kim Key got rubies and gold. And it's fit for a Kushite king. But what it look like? The green Sahara ring bearer bring terror to your satellite kingdom. So they do not bother me. Scarification look like wavy line pottery. Kush with the black top pots. A rap top notch. And I could kick you till your laptop stops. I'm like Tahar. Shabaka, or Bianchi, the author's a father. Any cocky, I came down to now through the lands of Kush, living a pre-dynastic Pharaoh way in Marrow way. Kerma, Khartoum, or Semna by the fifth cataract. Now I put the fifth wheel on the Cadillac. So much ride, a white man couldn't battle that though, they had to paddle back.
Black Egypt, Black Egypt. Black Egypt.
You gotta look and see where the now started.
Black Egypt.
And how it was easier to go downstream than upstream. Let me share this link a little bit.
Black
Egypt. The river flow. Don't
Black
look at the
Egypt.
Color, look at the culture.
Black Egypt.
What you know about Dynasty 00? Roll through with Shimsu Heiru on the standard. Ta-Nehisi, Sudanese G's. Try to test me. I'm an archer from Ta-Seti. The squad ready, so I'm stepping in with the extra thin leopard skin. A tail on the apron with my crown on. You can crack jokes, but I ain't the one to clown on.
Ayo, Egypt was black, and that's a fact. All you little suckers need to step on back. They tried to throw us off, but we kept on track. We started doing research, what you slept on that.
And with Kemet, it don't matter what the name mean. If it's a black culture, then that's the same thing. Race science is a lame thing. Ever since Nubian times, I let the chain swing. How the first known of Egypt was Ta-Seti. But Ta-Seti was Ta-Seti already. Yep, it meant the land of the boa. When Egyptians needed archers, this is where they would go to recruit them. I got arrows and I'll shoot them. Who them fake pharaohs? I uproot them and usurp them.
Black Egypt.
I had to bring that back one time.
Black Egypt. Black Egypt. Black Egypt. Black Egypt. Black Egypt. Black Egypt. Black Egypt.
Bang, bang, bang. What's up with it? Hope y'all can hear me this morning. My wife set me up with this cup. I told her, why you set me up like that? What's up, though? How y'all doing this morning? How's everyone? Just chilling, finishing my morning work. Getting ready to socialize for a minute. You get up early, you be done early in some instances. Depending on what you do. What I had to do today was make sure people understand how to participate with the opportunity we got going on. So I had to update this website so that people get to dig it in on this opportunities we got out here. So I just put some information up about so people can understand how to, oh, I should have made this a link, how to take advantage of the opportunity at the Bar Dow LLC. You know? So yeah, what's up with y'all? I ain't tripping. I'm cool. You can just take that out for me. I don't need that. Thank you. Appreciate it. Yeah. So I'll handle a few things. Get ready to have another cool day. Relaxing, Ernie. How y'all doing out there? I'm trying to wait for some people to roll in. I see man himself in the chat. A few viewers in the building. What's up? I ain't gonna rush it though. I'm not going to rush it. Just chilling. So, yesterday, this book came. Wonderful book. Shout out to the people. Like, yeah, go on and get that book. That mug right here, boy. Believe it or not. Well, see, if you could understand what type of book this is, if I could show you one page. I went through this yesterday. I didn't read it. I just went through the attestations because it's really not one of those type of books. It's like a book of attestations. See, I told you my wife set me up, gave me her coffee cup. But I ain't mad at it. Let me see. What's up with Six Fingers in the building? Shout out to y'all. Like the video so we could get it popping. So I wanted to look over that book to make sure that I was right about a few things. I knew I was right, but I couldn't trust the TLA that bad. I was like, that's over-trusting the TLA. So what I did was went in on a particular term, Kim Err, and got that book by Pascal Werner, which actually has all of the attestations of Kim Err in it. It got more than the TLA. It got all of them. Like, it got attestations that we ain't even know about. Because he used some unpublished works too. And just like I assumed, now I can say it with confidence, we definitely have Commit to You. A name for some, what they call Egyptians, before we have the land of Egypt. Before we have Kemet being called black. Peace, Chuck Morgan. Shout out. Thanks for tapping in nice and early. I don't know where everybody at, but I'm going to wait. Hopefully people roll in and make a good stream. But in that book, just going over it with my magnifying glass last night, I went over almost every, and it's written in French. I went over almost every attestation, at least for the time periods that I had to make sure. And, you know, I'm going to keep doing it going on, but it starts to become irrelevant because what happens is we learn that Kim Err was never called Kim Et in ancient times. I'm talking about, they start calling it, I could tell you everything now. That's why I love that book. First time they called the Kemet was during Amenhotep III. All right. So we talking about them saying something about some people called Kemet to you during the time period of Pepe II. So that's a big old, about 1,000 years, a little bit over 1,000 years apart. So that's significant. But I'm chilling. I ain't gonna rush in. This stream got people looking like I'm playing video games or something. So I'm gonna wait, see what's the problem. I'm not like that, but even people close to me told me they don't be getting my notifications. So if you step in the house, put a chat in the comment in the chat, like the video, any of that'll help. So I'm almost done with that subject. I mean, yeah, I'm almost done with that. When I put in the work that I need to, I know what I can say. I'm willing to discuss it, debate it, whatever. But we've did an exhaustive overview of those terms. And it's time for something else. Especially after I read this book yesterday. Because I didn't read the book after I looked over those attestations. If I could show you what one page in the book looked like, you'd understand. I downloaded an app called Photo Translate, and that mug was work hella good. So I'm just taking snapshots of pages, and it's giving it to me in English. But I didn't have to read none of that. It's about reading the metal nature and seeing if the Kim glyph and that bull was used before the 12th dynasty, which it was not. So that's a big question we got now. Kim Ur wasn't even popping like that. And what you learn from reading a book like that is scholars do not look for Kim Ur. Just like I told us, because that was the first, it was just the deity of the region. They looking for another term when you want to talk about a Threbus. And it's not even Hoot Hori Ob, which I thought it was. I mean, Hoot Hori Ob is the location of the center of the building in Kim Ur. But it go by Heru Kenti. It's something like Heru Kenti. Heru Kenti Kenti. You. Peace, Cedric. What's up? Trying to get it popping off in the morning. Must be something going on I don't know about right now. Sometimes you don't look at the YouTube world and something be happening and you be just like, oh, that's what everybody doing. But I ain't in no rush to get it popping today. But the term that they most often referenced Kim Ur with was by a deity, one of the attributes of Horus, which was Horus Kenti Henti. Horus Kenti Kent, something like that. It's crazy. So if I put Hor, let me try to find it. I know it's not going to be easy to find it here. Horus Kenti Kent, R-K-R-X-T, Horus Kenti Keti, Horus Kenti Keti. A name I never heard nobody ever mention. Have you? Oh, I haven't. So I'm going to put X-N-T-Y, then I'm going to put X-T-Y. Just to see real quick. I'm putting capital X's. So now I'm just going to put the first one. I need to put a lowercase X. And I need to change a few things. Don't put a Y, put a J. Because I use J's for Y's here. Peace, peace, peace. What's up, Rakim? I see the chat tapped in on the side. I'm saying I'm ready to put that issue to rest about the meaning of Kim. I've done enough work to know no matter what nobody say, they on something else. Can't argue forever, you know, and try to prove stuff forever. So, this is the Kenti, but this is like the foremost of the harem. This is a Kenti statue. I'm just talking about Kenti like foremost. Kenti, I'm into you. We understand Kenti mean like the foremost or in the front. I had to play my songs 3 times this morning. Waiting for the stream to get out. So yeah, I don't know no references to I mean, let me see. Watch this. Hentyk. I'll say Khety. Horace Kenty Ketty. See, look. That's who you looking for right now. Okay, I see a few people rolling in the building. What's up with y'all? What's up, Donnie Williams? Arrows up. If you roll in, do me a favor, say what's up in the chat or just like the video just to help the stream get out so we can have a more powerful session. See this Kenty Ketty? I was trying to say that. Remember when I was struggling with that earlier? It's kind of like a tongue twister. Horace Kenty Ketty. Not really a tongue twister, but when you got it in your memory and you're trying to remember it from the transliteration of the glyphs, it was a little bit harder. So when we talk about Kim Ur, it ain't even really Kim Ur. Horace Kenty Ketty appear more than actually Kim Ur is what we learn. And so when we really want to learn about that area, we're going to do more work on Horace Kenty Ketty. Dang, I hate to have to go get $100 books and bring back this knowledge like this. Because I know damn well ain't nobody ever said nothing about no damn Horace Kenty Ketty. But shout out to y'all who made it possible. So I was like, I need this book. And Cat Start Cash Apper. So look, so salute to you. The translation of the name Kenty Ketty, whose name is rendered in Greek as Kenty Chata or whatever, Tia, is uncertain. Although the meaning of Kenty element is clear, it means the head or the chief, as it is found numerous divine names or epithets, like Kenty Amentiu. That's the foremost of the Westerners. Notice that Amentiu has a T-U on it, and it makes it inhabitants of the West in that instance. But let's not be deceived about that. We went over the T-U bird. Now let's go with Kenty Kenty, who has a cult center at Athribis, see, in Lower Egypt, is depicted as a crocodile. See how we be messing that up? Now, this is what I hate. I hate when I unmess it up for people and then they go back and act like that ain't what I did. Like everybody gonna be like, he was the crocodile. But we got YouTube videos. I'm only saying this for a reason. It's because this is one of the keys to our conversation about Athribis, but we just not really understanding it all the way. So now when we see the crocodile on the standard, and you notice that one in a few of the attestations, well, we'd have to see in the book where they show the crocodile on the standard, there is a gnome. Let's go back and look at the gnome map too. And there was a place called Crocodopolis too, but listen, I don't want to throw us off. He's depicted as a crocodile or a crocodile-headed man, or later as a hawk-headed man. So when he becomes the hawk-headed man, I guess that's Horace Kenty Kenty. But really, I don't know Kenty Kenty standing alone as we looked over the attestations last night. Kenty Kenty is most normally Horace Kenty Kenty. But let's look at this consort Kuit. He has a consort Kuit. It says the calendar cites the 23rd day of the month as Koyak, or the day of which was founded in the heart of Osiris, which was in the possession of a crocodile who watched over it. This is Kenty Kenty. He had hidden it under his own heart at Athribis. Now that's interesting, because we know about how the heart comes in to Athribis. Maybe I've just been doing too much research on this one location just to be cool with it. Because Hoot Horiab We know hurry up means the middle. Time to open up the dictionaries. So let's talk about a hoot. And the funniest thing about a hoot I like is it is our primitive modern word for hut, for a house. By definition, and this is more of the reason why I transliterate the ancient Egyptian W as a U, and I never leave it as a W and say Winnie. I often try to say Unes because I think it was a U and not a W. Because of that word and words like that, the ancient Egyptian word hoot, well, I'll show with the dictionary. My dog snoring in the background. I don't know if y'all can hear. Let me see. Oh, thanks. All right, let me get all this stuff out of here. What's up, anybody who just rolled through? Who? Where's it's 300 hoots in here. But I mean, a hoot is like, so tep hoot is, did y'all know in ancient Egypt, they slept on the roof? So they sleep on tep hoot, or the top of the house. And so that's what they getting from this hoot. So you take this W and make it a U, and you got huts. A hut to us is a primitive word for a house still. But I don't want to go too far. I just was tripping off that. It is hoot, Horiab. Now let's go to Horiab. H-R-I. Maybe I should put H-R-Y. Horiab. I don't got that. All right, I'm just going to put middle. Somebody say Horiab. M-I-D-D-L-E. Let's see what they got. One of them going to say Horiab, and it's going to... There it goes. First one, see? Middle. You see, this is the heart right here. And so when we was, and the temple of the three was, is called Hoot Horiab. The house in the middle. Or the house, if you say it literally, you're going to say, look, Horiab in the heart of. Oh, he said they still sleep on the roof today. That's interesting that you said that. Jamil, shout out. So now think about it. If we got Hoot Horiab, it is in the center of the area we call Kim or Thebes, but it's the temple in the center. Now look at what they told us in the story about him. They said, this is Kentiketi. He had hidden it under his own heart at a Thebes. So we didn't know about, if we was just thinking about a Thebes, we wouldn't understand that. But if they said he had hidden it under his own heart at Hoot, they would have to say, Amen, under, what's under? I mean, you know, to hide would be something like, if this was a text and this papyrus and it said he had hidden it, how would you say that? Something about, I mean, you know what I'm saying? Basically, he hid it under his, I forgot under, but his heart is ib or ob, however you want to say it, right? Now, the reason why I'm pointing that out is because you was going to say, just like we talk about the wordplay, you was going to say something about, I mean, what, Ib, and then you was going to say Hoot Horiab. You see what I mean? He hid it because it's not a Thebes. It's Hoot Horiab, the heart. So he hid it under his own heart at Hoot Horiab. You see what I mean? At his heart or the in the middle of his heart or whatever at the location which represents the middle of his heart. Similarly, in the spell to heal a cat, the operator affirms, you cat here. Your heart is in the heart of Kenti. See why they keep on talking about the heart. And I'm just, he didn't say that in the text, but we all should know that there is a heart, which is Hori Ab, at the center of Athribus. So it says, you cat here, your heart is the heart of Kenti Keti, the Lord of Athribus, the chief of the gods, who keeps hearts and breasts firm in their places. They keep on talking about a heart, and I didn't even know. He has in your heart in his place, your breast in his firm. It says, the court in Kenti Keti is sometimes associated with the judgment of the deceased by the weighing of the heart in spell 125 of the Book of the Dead. All right, so now we see how he is related to Hut Hori Ab just by knowing the language, by some stuff that they never even said in this text. But notice they didn't say that Kenti Keti was Horus Kenti Keti. They only said he was depicted as a hawk-headed man. A hawk-headed man, which we know becomes Heru. And that was just somebody's WordPress. Oh, here we go. Now British Museum will tell you better. Horus Kenti Keti. See how this works when we're looking over sources? So they just don't even got nothing on it. They just tell you Horus Kenti Keti, another name, Horus. It says, okay, they're not going to even show nothing on that. Lastly, we got Ancient Egypt Online. Uh-oh. Uh-oh, they just gave you one. Now, look at this. Now you're going to have to look at this, because this is going to be a mess up, and we're going to have to beat them up on this. Damn, they didn't do that, y'all. Oh, my God. Keep on doing it. Y'all see what it's like? Foremost of Kim. I need that attestation. I'm going to show you how to look for it right now. Because they're trying to give us the sham blam and say he the foremost of the blind, y'all. It's going to keep on keeping on. But we're going to see that this Kim ain't going to be the Kim that they want it to be. And now we about to have okay, it's about to work out. Because you know they're not fooling us. Horus Kitty Kim is going to be the Kim glyph I6 black. Watch. That's what that's about to be. The foremost of Kim, the patron of the blind, when his eyes, the sun and the moon, were visible, he was known as Horus Kenti Urti, he who has two eyes on his brow, but neither were visible. He was known as Horus Kenti in Urti, he who has no eyes on his brow. So the Kim word for blind, if that's saying that, then they might be right. Let me see. We're going to look into that. It was thought that he was particularly dangerous when he was blind, damaging enemies and friends alike. Oh, it's going to be definitely fun to look into this. This form of Horus was worshipped in Kim in Lower Egypt. Letopolis, awesome. That's awesome, y'all. That is awesome. Let me see. Letopolis. So look how they spell this Kim. So this is the other Kim. This is a different Kim. It looked like somebody put this up in. So, we're going Kim like that with another glyph in front of it. It got that KH hawk sound that they suppose this goes to. And I'm just trying to look into this. So, I'm looking at Letopolis or whatever they call it. All right, so that is irrelevant to what I was. It just was a coincidence. But they had it spelled different. And so I'm glad they got some attestations to it right here. Two eyes on his brow. Where did they get the on his brow from on here? Oh, look, this is the one with no eyes, yup. See that negation right there? That N is no eyes, so there go the eyes. The foremost of the blind. This isn't Horus with no eyes. This is Heru Kenti, the foremost of the blind. What would y'all say in the chat? Because you wouldn't say Horus with no eyes, right? Well, you might have to say no eyes because this one got an eye right here. So you can't say the foremost of the blind. You'd have to look, anybody like y'all don't gotta read Madunetsu to chime in on this. Heru is the bird in the beginning, right? We got Kenti. This means the foremost. Now we got an eye. And we got a determinative for two eyes. But down here we got Heru, Kenti, and an N for negation and two eyes. He said, that's Elder Heru, the one he said. I'm not particular which one you was talking about, but what's up with Asar MK? It would be cool to say that this is the Heru with no eyes, but if you wanted to, but you don't read it like that. It's because normally you're gonna say the foremost of. So is this the foremost of those with no eyes? Horus with no eyes. Why they keep saying on his brow? Oh, you don't know why? Oh, I know why they're doing that. Because I think Kenti is another word for your forehead. I could be wrong, but I think Kenti is another word for forehead. Watch this. It's gonna say Hati, not Kenti. But forehead. Let's see if Kenti is another word for forehead. Tab. Fem. Tab and them, huh? So they go to Royal Uraeus. Hold on, I gotta go in and make it smaller. I mean, maybe that's not a forehead. The henet. Hot. See, this is the one I knew for forehead, so I was mistaken it for hot. Oh, nope. Look. Okay. Told y'all, man. We ain't that wrong, bro. We don't be that wrong. Kenti is another word for forehead, but look. Let's look at how it's working. We don't be that wrong. We just be trying to figure it out. So this says M. Kenti or M. Kent. But notice is the face, the upper part of the face or the forehead. So they saying that this Kent, man, they stretching that. But it makes sense with that, though. So he ain't the foremost of the blind. It appears they not making a stretch with on his forehead. Y'all see that? This is M. So the M is part of this word, and Chris was showing me something about this yesterday, that this is kind of prepositional or whatever. I mean, it is a different type of a phrase because we know this phrase stands alone as Kenti. So they put M. Kenti, just like sometimes we have, see, M. Kent, therefore, forth, for. So M. Kent is still in front of, okay, at the head of, eyes at the head of, so they said on his forehead. I just was saying the foremost. You know, and so that's good. You could get stuck doing that all day. So yeah, Horace Kenty Kim appears a lot when we want to learn about a Threebus. And so I'm not stuck on that no more. I'm ready to dead it. Like I said, I got all of the sources. It's public. Anybody could have the book. And if I could, I'll share it, but I can't. And so really what it is nobody in the old kingdom saying nothing about no Kemet ever. Besides the time when, I mean, they talking about cattle. They completing the cattle count. Or they talk about Kemet to you. And so that's well sourced. A few people that rolled in the building, shout out. It didn't took a minute. You know, it's 9 a.m. where I'm at. So. I got on it kind of early. So again, the book is a Threebus text. It's a French book. It's a Threebus text et textis. E documents relative à la géographie, aux cultures et et la histoire d'une ville du Delta Egyptian épique pharaonique. I know I said that hella wrong, but that's what it say. And so this is Pascal Vernis. In it is every attestation of a Threebus. I tell you where, and the majority of them are towards Heru Kenty Keti. All right. But now the coldest part about it is because this is why you want the books. Because the one that eludes all of us, all of the research we've done, I'm watching everybody's show, is this first attestation. And now I got to go into my phone to read. Feel me? And it's some other place. But this is the cold part. This is why we had to learn about the crocodile first. Because when we show you here. Kenty Keti is in the first attestation of Kim Ur as the crocodile. We so raw. So this happens in Liangxin Empire. And I need to get my phone. So we got the translator app, y'all. And it worked hella good. Translatorship. I already took these photos yesterday, so I guess this will be photo number one. And then the cool part about it is save your translated photos. And so what make that even better is I'm like, man, I could just put out a translation of this book. Let me see. So detect English language yesterday. 14 is later. So this must be the first one. Yep. So after centuries and centuries, the scientists who have studied a distant region toponym and the customs of its inhabitants may still gap in them such legend well prior to Christianity. It says, already misunderstood and forgotten at the time, endowed and with in the name given to a rock and a religious rite, remains in the middle of the presence of the emotional nation. Immemorable and stable. That was just a quote starting the book, actually. So I want to get to the part about this first source. So we can see it's like Orcasin or something. Oh, yeah, I got that already. I've seen that already.
All right, well, what is it? Right now, before I say it, since you've seen it already, put it in the chat. What's that first source on Athrebus? Not even tripping off, no. Kim, they wasn't even on that. They was on what you call it. That's not the part. I'm just looking for this one part. You got to forgive me. Here, this should be it. So it says warning. Not after the warning. Right after the warning. All right. All right, how about I just do it over again instead of wasting all this time? Just to read where this first attestation is from, take a picture, look, and it's just gone. I mean, obviously, y'all know this ain't nothing. They give me the book back in English right here, and now it's, look. Now I'll just read the whole page. So it says, documents from Athrebus are centered around Athrebus, chronologically classified. Documents 1 through 182, the old empire. Now, first of all, no monument of the old empire was found on this very site of the old Athrebus. See how they start with a dagger? How they was talking about. See how they start with a dagger? How they was talking about Kim Ur when they said commit to you in the old kingdom. When I looked at the first translation, it said, damn, he tossed me like some golden nunchucks right out the gate. It said, no monument of the old empire was found on the very site of the old Athrebus. We only have some very indirect testimonies. Now, here it is. It is Kusarkov funerary temple seal. The Kusarkov funerary temple seal. Let me try to pull that up. That beat all of us. That ain't in the TLA. Come on, man. When we go and get these Jews, just say we getting these Jews. We all gonna do this. We all be doing this. I said a funerary. No, I just put that right. I put an extra E, huh? No, I did that right. Oh, I put an R. I'm tripping. Burn. There you go. No, this is, so here's the thing. I don't know if it's Usher, yeah, Usherkov. Yeah, that's what he was spelling in French. Okay, so let's see what this goes to. Old Kingdom. In this mortuary temple here. Okay, look at the fella. Fifth dynasty. What I tell you. Woo! All right, so there you have it. Now, these seals were often affixed. Look, it was on the seal of fabric in the funerary temple. It said these seals were affixed on the strips of fabric which closed the vases. On one we read, Henty Henty, which resides at, and then it is broken. It says, if the resolution of Capoloni, Hori Ibbu, is arbitrary, Hori Ib, remember? Hori Ibbu. So the place of in the middle, Bu being the place, Hori Ib. So this is how I love this. I can't front because it'll show you the book, right? And then if you tap it, it put the translation on top. So I just been sitting here doing that is instead of typing everything into Google. It makes it kind of easier for me. And so he says, Hori Ibbu is arbitrary. We will follow him carefully when he proposes to restore him the tear behind the epithet of the god. like none of the others imprints published by Capilon, it says, does not mention the clerical external for those of royal funerary cults. It would be necessary to apply a cult of Kenti in the temple of Urserkoff. And so what we're looking at is actually one of the earliest attestations. I believe we're going, his successor was Sahure. So when people say it started with Sahure, now look at this. I'm just loving how the sources ain't no punk no more. What does it say right here? His highest year was the third cattle count. Shout out to Boom. I appreciate you for supporting the channel and the work we do over here. I ain't got no light, but I don't need no light. The work we do over here. Look, the third cattle count. Why they put that there? We're going to start to understand the cattle count. His highest year was the third cattle count. What does that mean to you? If we don't understand what I've just been learning lately, and I've been studying this for a while, so I don't want nobody to feel like because they don't know nothing. No, it ain't never that. I'm just saying if we don't understand the importance of the cattle count, if we don't understand the importance of the cattle count, what Asar M. Khan is saying. He said, but I'm not sure. But actually, if we go, I don't know what source Rezi provided, but it appears that this is talking about Urserkoff's cattle count, and his successor was Sahure. If there is an attestation before this one, so he had a cattle count in each of his reign. So you have a cattle count in the beginning as you come into the king. Then at each Rimpet Sep, you have a cattle count. Let's go in on it. We're about to really go in on it and give you the most exhaustive information that you can get on that on YouTube. You know what I'm saying? Why people be sitting on their channels disgruntled all day? Don't be disgruntled all day on your channel. It ain't good viewership. You know what I'm saying? All right, so here we go with the chronology. Wait a minute. Is this the one I want? Eric Harung, Ancient Egyptian Chronology. Eric Hornung, yeah. Eric Warnung, Roth Cross, David. All right, look. We're coming in this book to discuss certain things. Page 174, I think we need. First of all, we could go in on what he say about the Palmero Stone either. So, and if you investigate the Palmero Stone, they did very good work on it, coming up with the name of Kim Ur. But in all actuality, when you look at it, you're going to be like, oh, that was good work. 174, I think, is the page that we're looking for. It didn't pop us right to it. But we're talking about the 4th and 5th dynasties. So I want to go to page. They got 174, so maybe 173. But the beginning of the... Am I wrong? Maybe it was 124. Yeah, this say dynasty 12. Excuse me. Let me go to 124. Because I want to give us more information about... Yeah, I seen 143. Oh, yeah, 124 going to be 4th and 5th dynasty. All right, 127. All right, cool. So this is what I'm just going to read some of this for us to understand some stuff. All All right. The contemporaneous evidence for the relative chronology of the fourth and fifth dynasty. The contemporaneous evidence. The evidence that existed and thrived at the time of the events discussed. For the relative chronology. Okay. Of the dynasties fourth and fifth. Now, we came here because so that people can keep in focus. We came here to substantiate the importance of the cattle count. And the cattle being Kemet. Before Kemet. And we've seen these black cattle equated with the Pharaoh in many ways. The bull. He was the bull of bulls. He wore a ritualistic bull tails in ancient Egyptian ceremonies. So they say here his highest year was his third cattle count. Okay, so each cattle count, a cattle count happens when, starting with like the third of, well, actually starting with, I think, one of the pharaohs of the first dynasty, I forgot his name. All you got to do is research Egyptian taxes and stuff. At the beginning of you becoming a pharaoh or a Nisut, how powerful or how whatever, your reign is kind of depicted by your cattle count, which happens in certain years. Particularly one happens when you take the throne. And so now I'm going to let the scholars teach it. And I'm just going to read it. So we're talking about the fourth and fifth dynasties here. It says the crucial problem with reconstructing the relative chronology of dynasties four and five is our ignorance of how the system of dating according to the year occasion of the cattle count. Then he has Renpet Sep. You see? We all thought Renpet Sep was just the regional year. But as we further investigate, Renpet Sep actually has to do with the year or the occasion of the cattle count. When you see Renpet Sep, it ain't just in the regional year of this. Nah. It is in the occasion of the cattle count. So look at how this is broken down. Into the system of dating according to the year occasion of the cattle count, Renpet Sep was employed. Ever since Gardner's paper, specialists have acknowledged that the census formed the basis for counting regional years. Hold on. During the Old Kingdom. Stop. Let's stop right there. The census of cattle formed the basis for counting regional years. A regional year is a year of your reign, correct? So, if the census of cattle was the basis, how come the census for riparian ain't the basis for counting regional years? How come the census of the are the annual now flood, how high the flood meter goes up, ain't the basis for counting regional years? It's because we could probably presume that this was cattle culture. Cattle culture that came up out of Naphta Playa, as we know, as they say, that migrated into Upper Egypt before it was Upper Egypt and set up all the precursors to the religious implements we find in ancient Egypt. So, the existence and use of the term Renpet Imhotep, which is the year after the count. All right? So that right there just actually put hands on what Renpet Sep was thought to have meant. This is work right here. Ever since, up and now it says, the existence of the term Renpet Imhotep, the year after the count, was taken as clear-cut evidence for biennial census. However, that means they would count it twice or whatever, or every 2 years or one, whatever. Biennial, what, that's twice a year? Let me see. Let's see, is biennial twice a year or every 2 years? What y'all think, every 2 years? Biennial is taking place every other year. Yeah, so that's every 2 years.
Biennial. All
right. So every 2 years or every other year. However, the preponderance of Renpet Sep over Renpet Imhotep, years amongst the burgeoning number of data, I mean, years amongst the burgeoning number of dates recovered in recent years from excavations taken in conjunction with the entry on the Palmero stone attesting the cattle count in two successive years of Seneferu indicates that the situation is much more complex. So what is he saying? He's saying, hold on, we got to go look through these cattle counts to really see what's going on with the relative chronology of Egypt. He gonna break it down. Nowadays, some Egyptologists maintain that the census was biennial during Seneferu's reign, with the sole exception of the 7th and 8th counts, which were conducted in successive years. See, if the count was biennial, and they saying that's a regional year, then that would really be 2 years that he reigned and not one. Y'all feeling me now? He gonna break it down though. It says, others are of the opinion that the biennial system was not employed under Seneferu, while yet others equivocate. Mm-hmm. For subsequent reigns, opinions fluctuate from the presumption of biennial system to the assumption that the certain occasions an odd count could have been ignored. Finally, there is also a theory that the annual cattle count became more of a frequent during the Old Kingdom until it became a rule by the end of the 6th dynasty. So what are we talking about here? Because all of these things is happening about the 6th dynasty that got to do with Kemet, and the likes of such. For real. We find Pepe talking about the black cattle and this the black skin, all of the stuff that's 6th dynasty. So, but let's still talk about the, let's still stay on this cattle count census and the importance it has to us in understanding the length of the reign of a Nisu. Obviously, the existence of the census per se is not an issue, but rather its regularity during the Old Kingdom. However, a statistical review of documented dates, even if the list is incomplete and the attribution of some contested, allows some conclusion. For example, from the beginning of the Dynasty 4 to the end of the Dynasty 5, the year of the count and those following the count occurred in succession. So the years of the count and those following that count, they occurred in succession. And Renpet Sep years were consistently more frequently documented than Renpet Imhotep years. So Renpet Imhotep years are the regional years after the count, But he's saying during Dynasty 4th and 5, the years of the count and those following the count occurred in succession. And Ren Pet Zep years were consistently more frequently documented than Ren Pet Imket Zep years, the years after the count. Moreover, no clear-cut tendency can be observed towards a marked decrease in the number of years following the count through the period. Moreover, no clear-cut tendency can be observed towards a marked decrease in the number of years following the count throughout the period. All right. On the contrary, the evidence for Rimpet Zep and Rimpet Imhet from Seneferu's reign at the beginning of the fourth to Jet Kara's at the end of the fifth dynasty support the opposite conclusion. Now, could a cattle count take place in the year of a king's ascension to the throne? Meaning, exactly what he said. Until quite recently, the opinion prevailed that the first cattle count could, of any given king's reign, occur during the first full year of his ascension. My eyes starting to do a number on me now. But it says, but an entry among the annals inscribed on a stone recently discovered in South Saqqara cast doubt on this assumption, since the text explicitly mentioned a cattle count from the year of the unification of the two lands at the beginning of Mer-Enra. The potential usefulness of this series, though incomplete, of Rimpet Zep and Rimpet M. Zep dates to the 4th and 5th dynasty, demonstrates an analysis of the data for both Seneferu and Jet-Kara. So I'm going to stop because it's hurting my eyes now, and I'm going to turn to the left because I don't even want to look at the screen. God damn. But that shit hurt. Not hurt, but it's just be like making my eyes sting sometimes. Staring at the monitor too much. I can't read no more. So he says the hunt in the desert from the pyramid temple of King Sahurai. So adding an extra year to the reign of each king. So that's what they're talking about here, basically, Asar Imka. And they're pondering whether Seneferu is that king we need to add additional years to. And he's going to go in on that. But I'm at the point where I can't read it. But y'all can just read it on the screen right there for yourselves. He's breaking down. So it says, down to the present, the highest recording of Rimpet Zep years for Seneferu is 24. Only half of them are documented amongst the preserved dates. Can we assume that about the same proportion, i.e. of half the evidence for the intervening Rimpet Imket Zep years remain to date unattested? If so, the number 3 of such currently documented dates, Rimpet Imket Zep years 10, 13, and 18, should be doubled. And the estimate for the length of Seneferu's reign based on these dates would be 30 years. So I don't even want to go in on that, but this book is good and this is accepted and appreciated scholastic work. It's just stuff we never talk about and need to know about. I only wanted to bring this forth to stress how the periodization and the dating of dynasties is going to fall back on the cattle count. I know, and then I need to get some reading glasses. You're right, man. The ones I got is just some readers made for reading books. When I read a book, I actually be doing this, y'all. See that look? Y'all can probably see. Can y'all see that back there? I'll make it bigger. Hold on. See if y'all can see that. My eyes. We're going to see if we can read this back here. Even though. So, you can't see my name on it, though, huh? Lowdown Dirty Shame. Y'all know I was on that Lowdown Dirty Shame soundtrack back in the day. I'm going to get you, sucker. Y'all don't remember that. But yeah. back to squinting my eyes and trying to just let them dry up. So here we go. Put your shades on. Yeah, that's what my dad said. Put on some shades. I really need to start reading with them shades on because that light be killing me. But I'm just not looking at the screen right now. I'm looking at my other monitor. But I don't want to, I don't want to lose track. So I'm just going to chill. So then, what else we just looking at? We just learned a lot of stuff. I'm about to open up a Zoom so I don't have to be staring at the screen. Let me see. We learned a few things that the cattle count was so big in ancient times that scholars are looking at reworking the chronology of certain dynasties based off that. Yeah, I'm not about to. That's why I be getting off the computer and go walk around my house. So that's what I'm going to do now, pick up my phone and go outside or something. But I did just share a link in the chat. If anybody want to discuss any of the things or join in, feel free to tap that link in the chat. And right now, I'm just not wanting to look at the screen. I'm going to look at this book. With my miggity magnifying glass. I like doing this. So if I can show y'all this one figure that we found from the funeral, it's still all fifth dynasty. Nothing exists about Athribis before the fifth dynasty at all. Chuck Morgan said, I'm really learning a lot about this topic. Much appreciated to all the Metal Netter reader. Inspires me to stay sharp in my language studies. Show word up, and you inspire me to stay sharp too, Chuck Morgan. Appreciate you. I got a lot of knowledge off your channel as well. Oh, let me see. What's up, Gary? I see you. Yeah, somebody hit the stream. I see we got brother Asar M. Kai stepping in the building, which is going to allow me to go on my phone. That's cool. What's up with it?
Man, what's good, fam?
Chilling, trying to make sure that I wasn't being pseudo by thinking that we had Kemet to you before we got Kemet. And, you know, they was trying to use the Athribis to wiggle out, saying, no, there's a meaning of Kemet for Athribis. But that ain't nothing, but that's 1,000 years later. So I think we got that. How you doing?
Good, fam. Good. Obi, I was writing in my book last night. I was like, let me add Smash and Saber real quick. So I threw your names in there real quick.
Appreciate that.
I was like, let me throw them in the mix. But yeah, that would definitely be the case. I ain't even going to touch the cattle count because that's, you know, Reggie is so focused in on that with the cattle. I ain't even going to touch it. I like him to run with it. Mm-hmm. And we always divulge stuff for him on it. Mm-hmm. But I would have to say that's on point. In fact, looking at the, where is it at? The start of the Shimsu Peru.
Oh, yeah.
That's when it happens.
Oh, yeah. So that's what I was tripping off, too. Because that's a checkmate. Because the Shimsu Heru is supposedly these people who say it's riparian land. But Shimsu Heru actually is the people who count the cattle. Exactly. You know we got this down packed. But right. I'm waiting to drop them bombs on them. The Shimsu whore is actually the cattle counters.
You know, you mind if I share my screen?
Oh, not at all. Actually, that's why I'm glad you're here. Anybody else, y'all got anything to say? Feel free to join the stream. It's all good.
So we start to look right at the brother that come right after Narmer. And here go the cattle count after relief in Mastaba Tomb G75 at Giza.
You feel me? Look, now let's click on that. Did you? Because I know. Don't let the word Kemet be on there. Don't let the word be like Kemet. Be like, oh, well, that's what they was talking about. Kemet to you then.
Right. It'll be over. Let me, hold up. Where is it at? Cattle count. See, the encyclopedia has the date, which is 3150, but.
So just so people see, we not clouding or making nothing up. He Googled cattle count, and the first thing that popped up was Shimsu Hor. Now, the Shimsu Hor is the ones who wrote this book that say Kemet means riparian land. But y'all name even mean cattle count. So you can't get away from how to answer. When you start messing with my eye, she going to get you.
She going to get you. And on top of that, let's be clear, because remember, I gotta shout him out. Patasa Karasar, he was the first ones shouting Shimsu Hor, Shimsu Heru. After they labeled him pseudo, because his calendar, then some Shimsu Heru popped up all of a sudden. Me and him was saying Shimsu Heru for a while, and I always say the Shimsu Asar, because the Shimsu Asar appear. I don't know if they appeared first, but they appear. So
they're actually saying Shimsu Heru was the name of the event, not the people who carried it out. But nevertheless, we know Shimsu means followers of Heru being Horus. So I think that would probably be the people and them carrying it out. Like you see the people carrying it out on that stella, that's probably Shimsu Heru. You feel me?
And this is the Giza Mastaba. You can see him counting it right there.
How big can I get?
I was trying to, you know what? Let me go here, because if I magnify my screen, it'll go. Yeah, see, there we go. Is that bigger?
Yeah, it definitely is. Yeah, people can see. And it's like millions to the right.
It is. And right here, yep. We can tell that they're right about the numbers, because right here we got 2,000.
Oh, I thought that said 2 million. I messed up. 2,000.
Oh, yeah, 2,000. The Hess symbol is going to be that million.
Oh, yeah, was she raising her arms up?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So we know they got... Remember when you read that text the other day, they definitely ain't exaggerating. Yeah. They're keeping it a buck over here.
1,236.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
1,235. See, if you guys have, and the guys you got, most of you guys listen to, they can do this. I know on the other side of this Black Land Riparian discussion, they can do this. I already know my man can do that. But when you guys listen to these other guys, we pulling up a stella and we counting right now. This is the primary. We just counting right here. See this? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That's 900. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 970. 1, 2, 3, 4. 974 cattle. If you can't pull up your stella and read it, and this is blurry. This is. I would expect them to make an excuse about this, and I'd say, okay, this is just us.
Oh, excuse me. I was turning on my phone. It's giving an echo.
See how powerful it was. It echoed on your us. So that's there right there. Plus, when we look at, let me back up so we get off of this. If we go to the Shimsu Hor, let me pull this up just so y'all can see it. central government in Egypt is evident by 3150 BCE when King Narmer unified the country, but some form of government existed prior to this date. The Scorpion Kings of pre-dynastic period Egypt, 6000 to 3150 BCE. They go into, where is it at? They're going to tell you when the Shemsu War get busy. And this is when we second, I think it not, was it second intermediate or the other? The economy, blah, 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 blah. Under the reign of Narmer's successor, Hor-Aha. So as soon as Narmer came down, Hor-Aha steps in. 3100 to 3050 BCE, an event was initiated known as Shemsu Hor, following of Horus, which would become standard practice for later kings. The king and his retinue would travel through the country and thus make the king's presence and power visible to his subjects. This is when the first cattle count happens.
So let me ask you, he didn't go through the country and check on the riparian land? I'm saying though, like, I'm just trying to keep it real
because he was making repairs. He was collecting them taxes so they could make repairs. But you know, there was no.
Because it was supposed to be so important, they need to show me the traditions surrounding.
And you can see right there, the Shemsu Hor, better known today as the Egyptian cattle count, became the means whereby the government assessed individual wealth and levy taxes. Each district known was divided into provinces, with the nomarch administering overall operation for that nome, or septot, as they called it, and was divided and then lesser provincial officials and then mayors of the towns. Rather than trust the nomarch to accurately report his wealth to the king, he and his court would travel to assess the wealth personally. The Shemsu Hor thus became an important annual, later biannual event in the lives of the Egyptians, and much later will provide Egyptologists with at least approximate reigns of the king, since the Shemsu Hor was already reported by
reigning. So we just read the back of the book on that homework to see, you feel me? So the world history is out here telling you that Egyptologists approximate the reigns of the kings off the cattle count. Then we went in the book where they saying, hold up, this cattle count may be off. He might have reigned for longer. Just tell me how they're using, you know, I'm just saying, I'm showing the importance of the cattle culture and the reason why a nation would possibly bear a name associated with such. You know what I'm saying? Because we see the importance of it. A king was named by it, and you have to show the importance of other things. And then when we have Timari being cited by Nibi as the cultivated land, which is a result of knowing that you're in a riparian zone, because you can't cultivate if you don't know you're in a riparian zone. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It kind of means that they already addressed that, but with the term Timari.
Yeah, and it's not like they denied the riparian zone. They called it Kemi Iyat. So all they got to do is just add the black part to the riparian Iyat, and we're good. Plus, Iyat also meant land. But yeah. So I don't know how they keep taking the left turn. Turn right. Turn right. Oh, you missed it again. Circle the block. Turn right. This should be. This right here is the checkmate, though, for Reggie's work, because that's what he's banking on, is that it means cattle. You know, it's about the cattle.
Well, we see how they equate the cattle to man. And so I'm not mad at that, because they equate the cattle to man when they do it with the bull. And the king is the bull of bulls. And then you could probably see somebody, and the black bull was the strong one to them. So you could see how people would start calling themselves Kim, to be saying, I'm like the black bull. And if the bull was black, you probably could really see if you really was like the black bull. I really like the black bull. Look, you know what I'm saying? And so, I mean, that's not far-fetched because we can't act like humans like we don't do human things. We make analogies and all. We know we're not walking around being linguists every day. We're walking around being human, and people just might make an analogy.
And we always, we say, I'm a pit bull. DMX. What's up, dog? Come on, dog.
Well, I really want to write a long document about how the art of eating MCs comes from ancient Egypt, and that how devouring was our chief poetic way to annihilate an enemy since ancient times. And we'll go from MCs today back to the cannibal him. You feel me?
Go ahead. I was going to say go to Atta and Hekinu, the first poets, the first girl poets. I pulled it up on a, I did a stream a long time ago about those two. Not focusing strictly on them, but those are your first known musicians, obviously not the very first, but they're the very first known musicians by name. So yeah, Atta and Hekinu. Let me pull them up. I think, matter of fact, I think if we just Google first singers in the world, it'll pop up. Let me see. Let me get off of that. First singer in the world. 6th century BC, Greek named Arion. Nope. Go all the way back. Ta Hekinu. I can't even remember how I pulled that up a long time ago. I got it though.
No, that's all good. But yeah, that cattle count and learning more about it thanks to Reggie and even thanks to the opponents of that view who caused me to dig deeper in. I'm learning more about repairing stuff too. It just ain't got nothing to do with Kemet. The time. No. But I'm also learning about that cattle culture, which is actually called Kemet. It's crazy.
That's what's wild. They I ain't saying nothing. We it's funny what's going on right now.
I mean, to me, this is over because I was waiting to get this book. Nobody can say we don't got Kemet to you before we got Kemet, and we have to have that discussion. Next is going to be what that mean then if Kemet wasn't there. You got to tell us what that mean. Those are the riparian?
Right. And that's what's going to be the problem, because you're going to run into stuff like this. You're going to run into... It's just too much you're going to run into.
You want to read that part about importance? Because it seemed to be everything we're talking about.
Well, let me go in there. The cattle count is of great importance to Egyptologists and historians because many inscriptions report the year of the XTH occasion of the cattle count, followed by the name of a pharaoh. Thus, these inscriptions are used to assess the minimum duration of the reign of the pharaoh. For example, assuming that the cattle count was held every 2 years, this last point being of paramount importance for correct datation of reign lengths, it is highly disputed up to this day. According to the Palermo stone, a black basalt stone slab recording the yearly events of cultic and religious nature from King Narma, first dynasty, down to King Neferirkara, Kake, third pharaoh of the fifth dynasty. The cattle count was performed every second year until the late Old Kingdom. After this period, however, it was performed more frequently and finally yearly. The first pharaoh during whose reign yearly cattle counts are known to have taken place with certainty is King Pepi I of the sixth dynasty. This does not exclude that the cattle count necessarily took place every second year before Pepi I.
So we just have to pay some attention to how things with the cattle count changed during Pepi reign, how we start finding these Kim people popping up, you know what I'm saying, during that same 100 years, and just all of these things. I mean, that's interesting at very least.
It is. Even the name of, I'll finish it out. Then we'll go, there's a very important book that goes into the name, and it discusses the cattle and death. An example of conflicting evaluations for reign duration via cattle count is the case of King Khufu, fourth dynasty. The highest known numbers of cattle counts under Khufu are found in workmen's graffiti inside the relieving chambers of the Khufu pyramid. The ink inscription reports the 17th occasion of the cattle count. Since the Palermo stone inscriptions hold that the cattle count was performed every second year during the fourth dynasty, what's 2 times 17, right? It would prove that Khufu ruled at least 34 years. This calculation is rejected by several Egyptologists because they always try to shorten our time. Because another ancient Egyptian source, the Turin Canon, credits Khufu with the reign of merely 23 years. At the opposite, the ancient Greek historian Herodotus claims that Khufu ruled for 50 years, which is now seen as an exaggeration. Meanwhile, today, Egyptologists such as Thomas Schneider assume that either Khufu indeed ruled for a little over 34 years, or that the author of the Turin Canon simply did not take into account the two-year cycle of cattle counts, and in fact credits Khufu with 23 cattle counts, which is a reign of 46 years. And that's probably what he did, because in ancient times, he's just going to say any reign this year and this year and this year and this year, assuming that it's the cattle count and everybody in the country knows that at that time. And we come around to Johnny come lately and say, oh, the cattle count is every 2 years. We figure it out. And they already knew that in ancient times. So it wouldn't be something that they have to, you know, put. And if they got 46 and he got 23, 23 plus 23 is 46.
Mm-hmm.
So 46 is close to 50. It's only 4 years off.
Exactly, and that's corroborating with ancient tale from Herodotus, as well as the new scholar Thomas Schneider, who seems to think his reign is about 46 years. And so what we're doing is pointing out the importance of cattle culture to Kemet, which the cattle were called Kemet. I mean, a black cattle was called Kemet. A herd would be Kemetiu in some instances. But we need Reggie to go in further on that. I'm learning things here.
Here, go right here. Just the other book.
Which book are we reading?
Let me go up. Lingua Egypta, Journal of Egyptian Language Studies, number 25, 2017. With Mayor Verlag from Hamburg. Let's go to page 26. Let's blow it up. This is Kim Ware. So here we got Kim Ware and we got that wall. I told you this wall gonna be important in my discussion.
It definitely is.
Kami Warrior, this is them breaking it down. See, it's got the two M's in there for them. Kami Mu, here's another spelling, Kim, Ware, and it's got the, this is when you want to try to speak riparian right here. Just want to help you out with this pool of water up here. They wouldn't need two pools of water, which tells you something about this when it's referred to as town, this piece below it. Kamiwa, all this here. Here it is in Coptic, Kimu, Kamu, Kamau. But he says, great black one. Bitter lake is the other translation. In his footnotes.
That one looked like demotic.
It probably is. It probably is. Let me see.
Yeah, it looked like
demotic. Yeah. Because this right here, I'm tripping. I want everything to be Coptic. So here we go. Where is it at? He starts to talk about the different attestations that they come across in here. And here he goes right here. This is when I was saying it was probably fourth dynasty. In the instruction for Merikara, number 99 by Quack. Quack is I like Quack's work. He states it here, Kimware, Bitter Lakes Papyrus Carlsberg 6, second column or something, line 9 or something, appears vis-a-vis. Kemi, right there, and you got the bull. They're calling this a Thebes. And we already know that don't mean a Thebes.
All right, but I see what they're saying because they got the locale glyph, they got the Kimi. Okay, that's cool. So, but what is Papyrus Carlsberg 629? The instructions to Merikara is dated to what?
I'm not sure of the date on that.
Can you just pop instructions? You can put copy instructions to Merikara and pop it in Google, see what it's like.
Oh, let me see. Twelfth Dynasty.
Okay. Yeah, so it would not be weird for them to have that town symbol or whatever next to it at that time. They do have it in some earlier instances, but that explains it a little bit.
And then let's go Papyrus St. Petersburg. Hermitage 1016A99, and here's it's jacked up, whatever it used to be. Presumably a Thebes is what they say.
So those three papyri is probably different copies of the instructions of Merikara. And that's why they're assuming that since it's scratched out on other dudes' papyri, because they be just copies of the same text. So it seems like they got three copies of it, so to speak. Papyrus Carlsberg, Emeritage, and Mosok. And on Emeritage, the word is scratched out, is what it looked like they're saying.
And as we go down, Quack, 1992, his book, pages 58 through 59, CF also a swamp called Kimi Ur in the 4th and 5th dynasty, Upper Egyptian known, let's 2014, I 48, the secondary use as a designation for the fire.
Interesting.
That needs to be researched. We need to... There's the demotic attestation confirmed right there.
I can pull those up too, but he gave us the sources. But that's all this book is doing, is giving us all of these sources and attestations. I'm about to look that one up right now.
This actually gives us the the names, and then it tells what the names are. These are his footnotes. Like he goes into Tahwear and all that stuff, and then he gives a breakdown, then he gives the Tahwear like the Great Land, but this he calls Great Black One, Bitter Lake. This is Kimware, the Great Black One. 10th Lower Egyptian Nome.
So it seems that the Old Kingdom accounts starts with that Usher Kaf one. I haven't found one before that. And then next is the Ptah Hotep at Saqqara. Then the Palmero Stone. And we looked over the Ptah Hotep at Saqqara. That's where the TLA starts. The Ptah Hotep at Saqqara has the epithet Kenti. Again, that Kenti, Kent. And then we find at but Ptah Hotep at Saqqara also has an attestation of Kim Ur. Then we find that Palmero Stone, some inscription of De Mag Hara, or the funerary text of Nasure. And then Ptah Hotep 2. So that's interesting because Ptah Hotep 2 is also there, and then we move on to the New Kingdom. And so it is what it is, but my little elementary point that I was trying to make is made, so I just need to see us chime in on what does Kemet to you mean if we did not have Kemet as an abbreviation for Kim Ur at that early time.
I sound like the Black community or the Black people at that time.
Well, some were still associated to the people of Kim Ur by way of Kim Ur being called Kim and just saying the T-U is that, but it wasn't even called that. That's what I'm saying. Is that what we find out? That was just the god of that region in that time. And so I don't know. It is what it is, though. But I've done enough to satisfy my suspicions, and I probably won't have much to say about that in the near future.
Now watch this. The god, right? And we just had the Shemsu Hor. So you got followers of that god. Now you got the god here, which is the Great Black One. If he's the god in that area, they're probably Shemsu of that particular god.
Oh, okay. They could be, but they didn't say Shemsu, they said Tiyu.
Yeah, the Kemet Tiyu, yeah.
So, I mean, all of the Tiyu ain't necessarily religious followers or something. One Tiyu that I found, Kemet Tiyu, is opponents. And so that's interesting, too. Because an opponent ain't an inhabitant of nothing.
No, they ain't even supposed to be there. They coming to scrap. They
have their mind, basically, as an opponent, but that I will do more research down that lines, but I've exhausted, it ain't worth it to me. I think when the fix is in, the fix is in. And when you notice it, I feel like I'm cool. You know what I mean? Like I've seen what I have to see. Unless somebody tell me, of course, how to commit to you, because even the scholars is asking the question, like, is this talking about a Threebus or no? They know a Threebus wasn't there. I mean, they know Kim Ur wasn't called a location like that at the time periods.
Right. But they trying to run with that anyway. The new scholars is running it off, which is the good thing. So
until somebody bring up that next intense subject that get me juiced for 6 months or whatever. I'm about to start working on my jet ski. I'm going to take that engine apart again for this winter and try to make it go faster. Put it back. I try to take it apart every, it's a project, but I try to take it apart in the off season and make it go faster.
That's the remote control piece?
No, just a water ski, a wave runner.
Yo, y'all be out there with the hydraulic pumps or something off of them, the things that float on water, them and they be standing on them.
Yeah, but that's probably Florida culture. I haven't seen too much of that in the Bay. But yeah. Uh-oh, Reggie got the other Nibby article. Reggie, come on. Come on, Reggie.
Come on in.
Click the link, Reggie. And so, come yeah, we might have some agreements or some disagreements with that Kim Guest article. I read what Asar said about it, and I don't necessarily... some of it is a stretch that the Kim glyph is the side of a hill. But Reg, whenever you ready to chime in, maybe you probably want to do some research on that article for a minute. But regardless, it'll be cool to have you giving your information.
Hop in the mix. I got to step off Smash. I'm going to talk to the chat. I'm going to talk to you, my brethren.
Word up. Thanks for tapping in. I appreciate it. All right. Peace. All right, let me see. Let me get back to my computer. I have to give my eyes a break. All right, yeah, that was a cool little morning build. About an hour and a half. I just closed down the Zoom. I'll open back one up. He said that deserves his own show. Yeah, word up, Reggie. Hit me off with that thing. I'm going to try to look over it. I appreciate you and your exhaustive research, boy. Shout out to brother Reggie doing this thing. And so, like I said, I have not, after getting this book and looking over those attestations and seeing that they don't, it appears from my skim over the book last night, the first time it was called Kemet or has a T with it. Kim R is doing, hold on, Reggie. Let me start another link. I didn't know you was trying to log on. I got time. Let me start another link. I accidentally closed that one down. All right, here's a new link. Please click the new link. There you go. And I'll be done about noon my time at the latest. That's a couple hours from now. Try to do 3 hours from 9 to 12. Start increasing my YouTube content. Thank y'all for supporting it. Making it do a good thing. I ain't fed up with my studies, but I've contacted a PhD. I bought some books, and I feel like I know what I know now. I don't want to, You feel me? Hey, Reggie, click that new link, though. I want to hear what you got to say. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So I'm glad I'm learning. I'm glad I'm learning things, though. Shout out to the chat. What's up? Anybody got any questions in the chat? I'm waiting to see if Reggie gonna click the new link. Hopefully we can get him in here. Are any of y'all who want to build or whatever? And that be, you know, I ain't even tripping. You gonna hit that, bud? You said you're trying to log on. Reggie, what's up? Anyway, it's cool. I ain't resting, but it was cool to learn a lot about this cattle count. You know, we heard about it. We knew about it. We always knew about how the bull was referenced and how the bull was important. Now we're learning even more about its importance and relationship to Kim Kemet and all of these things. All right, I'm going to get ready, too. If Reggie don't roll up in here in a second, I'm going to get ready to do some other things. Oh, there we go. We got good brother Reggie rolling up in here right on time. Probably give us more insight to some of the things we've been discussing. What's up, dog?
Let's see. Yo, your mic hooked up yet, Reggie? All right. Get that mic hooked up. Yesterday, I went and was doing my gaming right after I was streaming. I didn't know when I was flying that airplane, everybody had lost the view. Shout out to Reg. He says it's connecting right now. Everybody who can't see or maybe watching at a later time. We're going to get some insight from Brother Reggie about this cattle culture. I got a few questions to ask. Like, can we find, where's this Comete U for cows? And a few other things. I don't know. We having probably some connection issues right now because it's taking longer than normal. And it still says joining. In the meanwhile, I'll put some questions in the chat. Or anything y'all feeling in the chat. I got a good time to give y'all a commercial. Quick commercial about opportunities that we got going on at hieroglyphics.com. In learning all about the crypto space and seeing the proper way to do things, I had to actually go into Wyoming and register this company, a decentralized autonomous organization, because this is one of the only states that'll let you do one legally in the United States. So we have the Bar DAO, which is actually just like merging hip hop with the crypto space or the arts. Even if I think one of our first proposals that we might get turns into us won't even be about music. It's going to be about photo art or whatever or what have you, it appears. But here we have an opportunity for people to fund their projects or give funding towards their projects to the 10% of whatever this amount is, the assets under management. So right now, assets under management, 11,000. That means you could write a proposal for 1,100. And who approves your proposal? Your friends, your peers. You take your proposal, you write it, and put it on your Facebook pages and stuff. And if those people, if you get 650 votes, which you could consider a like, your proposal has a 49% of the 51% quorum it takes to approve. The final 2% vote to reach the approved quorum is reserved by the Bar DAO, just to make sure nobody's manipulating the system. But if you get your 650 likes, you're getting your paper. Just that serious. All you got to do is commit. You got to pay a registration fee, obviously, which is a small fee. And all you got to do is commit a percentage of the intellectual property back to the DAO. And you're going to be earning off of that, too. So as you do that, each member is going to be able to get passive income from the intellectual property we accumulate as digital assets. So that was a cool plug. Is Reggie back yet? You still ain't there? Reg, you here yet? It's like you're here now, bro. Where you go, bro? Oh, what's up with you, Reg?
Yeah, I had a difficult time connecting. I don't know why, but that's what it is.
So what type of mic you got? Is it a handheld mic? Is it by the computer? You got to scoot that thing forward or something. Like it's station. Yeah, you got to scoot that thing forward or something. you might need. I'm gonna send you a different tripod. I mean, mic stand or something.
Yeah, I don't. Sometimes it works. Sometimes I just gotta adjust it, and then I'm frozen again.
No, you're not frozen.
Oh, okay.
We might be frozen, but how are you?
All right, I'm fine. So after yesterday, I went to the Met Research Library and I called the Nibby book, right? The journal that had the Nibby article, and it has some interesting things to say, but I think it deserves its own show in your catalog on the Kim and the Guests, Nibby and the Kim and the Guests. That should be the title, right? And so we can go through aspects of that. It's not very long, but there's a there's an interesting thing that those opponents do. They leave out crucial material to make their point. And so for the people that study, I think that they need to see the author's original intent and then make their conclusion.
Interesting. Yeah, I've noticed that on several occasions when reading the source material. I'm like, oh, this is what he's saying. And so that's a setup for you when you do that with people's work.
Yeah. And so they think that for some reason they can get these forgotten books or these difficult books to get, and they have them and you don't. And so they get to say what the original author said, and the original author usually is much, much more detailed and profound, especially Nibby. Which show is it? It's the same show, or you created a new show, or how you
want? Oh, what you mean? No, this is the same show, but so yeah, I only probably got an hour more. Maybe we, if you're available tomorrow, let's go over it tomorrow. I would like to read it before I'm reading it live.
Okay, well, what I'll do is I won't say too much more, except for Nibby. In short, Nibby looks at the Gis glyph and the Kim glyph, and she says that they are related. She says that the Gis glyph is basically a part of a land, and that the Kim glyph is a mound where flowers grow, right? However, to kill them, and you just have to see it in print, she relates it to the black silt, right? And the inundation. She also said
I left that out.
Oh yeah, that's why I gotta show it to you. That's why it deserves its own show, right? Because she relates it to the black inundation. She also connects it to completion, as in the context of the when those seasons are completed. Right? So she connects it to still Kim in completion, but in the context of Kim directly as completion, meaning that that season is over with. And then that completion could be, of course, applied in another sense to another Kim, which is the cattle count, but she doesn't say that. She doesn't say that. She only talks about seasons, and we could say events. So they leave that out. We want to see exactly the diagrams that that those dudes put in their book is from Nibby. So obviously they've had all a part of the book, but what they do is they do selective analysis. They leave some things on the cutting floor. So won't say too much about much more until I send it to you in the next few minutes. But the fix is in. These people are not being honest scholars. They are trying to make their point based on leaving out information. And they laughed me up and down about the cattle count and its relationship. But in my article on the journal, I talk about aspects where humans are, in fact, the divine cattle. Humans, the Ramesh, or divine cattle. And I give at least two references where that is, where it's said. One in Merikari, instructions of Teddy to Merikari, where humans are the Neta or Wat, the divine cattle, and they should be provided for by the king. And the other one is in the Jedi the Magician, when he was supposed to be able to resurrect things. So they asked to cut off the head of a human. And then they used another term for divine cattle in that context. So humans are divine cattle not to be slaughtered, just like humans are not to be slaughtered in the Pert Imheru, which actually comes later.
Interesting.
So I give those references, in my journal article, because I was doing like what you're doing now, is that you're turning over all of the different stones, right, to make relationships that weren't necessarily there, or to verify, qualify associations that were there. But you're doing the detailed study that is needed instead of someone putting up a book. Now, have you ever seen a SARS presentation on?
Oh, let's watch it.
Okay, so that I can do on this show.
Let's watch that and Beatty real quick.
Well, we're gonna okay. Well, Beatty and him is longer. Beatty and his longer. I would have to find Beatty on Mario's, but I have a SARS on my page. So because I'm having internet problems, if you can go to my channel, Africa Online TV.
Okay.
And it's only 17 minutes, and we're gonna see a SAR Imhotep's trick bag. It's called so, YouTube
Africa Online.
Africa Online TV.
Okay, I just was handling some business. Let me close out this page.
It deserves its own show, and maybe we can come back to clips of it and do a show. But we're gonna see this dude. We're gonna see the magic. I'm talking Magi. We're gonna talk about the magic of what he does and what and then. But you and I know what he doesn't do.
Wait a minute, Africa Online TV.
Yeah,
I thought I was subscribed, but when I type it in. Is this your page? Let me see. No, this looks like somebody else.
On YouTube?
Africa Online TV. One word?
Yeah.
Hold on. They got one with where it's two words. All right, I see it. Africa Online TV. One word. Asar Imhotep ASCAP Conference?
Yeah.
All right, hold on just one second. This is this will be good. And bro, so
hold on, everybody let me share. Get your goddamn popcorn, yo. I had Dr. Mario Beatty. I had Dr. Mario Beatty asked him, there's a debate in our community on Kemet. I saw Imhotep and his people were saying it's not related to black.
Oh.
It's not related to it means riparian land. And based on his prior dealings with Asar, and then based on Asar's presentation, he will come out and he will make a statement about methodology that they did not like. So
I'm getting ready. Keep talking while I get ready. Keep telling.
And get your popcorn for this, because you're gonna see spin that should never ever be accepted in a conference of black people. Why can't black people do things right? Why can't we do things right? Why do we have to act like savages? Right?
Is that what happened? Dang.
In the context of intellectual discourse, right? When I mean savages, meaning do not apply rules. So you got it on, play it.
All right, tell me when to stop for your commentary and let me know if you can hear.
No, I don't need no commentary.
All right, 17 minutes. This is Asar Imhotep's presentation at the ASCAP conference on Kemet. Get your popcorn. Let's see some popcorn in the chat if y'all feeling this.
Yeah, so did his typical drink of water to clear his throat. Let me clear my throat.
The title of our presentation, excuse me, before I even start. May I have permission to speak by the elders?
Oh, we need to turn. That needs to be turned up. Let me see.
For those who don't know, my name is Asar.
Maybe, let's see if I can boost it. One second.
The title of my talk is called Tepesev, the correct method in the debate on the meaning of Kemet. for those who don't know, I first
It's really loud. Let me see what I can do. Hold on.
In 1998.
We can hear it.
And since then, I have debated with some of the top linguists, top Egyptologists, laypersons alike. And one of the things that I've noticed is that all of them lack method.
Wait, Smash. What top linguist did he debate with?
We got the commentary already. What you said there?
What top linguist? He calls other people lay people. But what top linguist did he debate with?
I don't know.
Nevertheless, guy.
All right.
This question. And so this talk is aimed more so at the young and future scholars and the importance of methodology when doing proper research. Next slide, please. Next. I want to start off with this quote from Sheikh Abdul Diop first to kind of put everything in context. When, in an interview, when he was asked, basically, what sort of preparations should young scholars make to undertake future studies in the field of, and I put Africology, Africana studies, Diop's response was, I would like to see above all a greater number of researchers, Afro-Americans, young Americans, and even whites. Why not? Because it's the young who are the least prejudiced. As a consequence, they are the most capable of making triumph ideas which frighten the older generation. Also, I think that it would be necessary to put together polyvalent scientific teams capable of doing in-depth studies, for sure, and that's what's important. It bothers me when someone takes me on my word without developing a means to verify what I say. We must form a scientific spirit capable of seeing even the weaknesses of our own proofs, of seeing the unfinished side of our work, and of committing ourselves to completing it. You understand? Therefore, we should then have a work which could honestly stand criticism, because what we've done would have been placed on the scientific plane. Now, the reason why this is something I expect from Diop, because unlike most of the people who have opposition to my point of view on this question, is that they're not scientists. But Diop was a scientist, and he understood that one's claims have to be falsifiable, that they have to be put to the test. And he challenged the next generations to challenge his work and not to believe it because he's the great Sheikh Abdul Diop.
But a source work can't be challenged.
As a computer scientist myself, I understand fully what needs to be done to advance the field.
He's a computer scientist.
So in that spirit, I'm involved in several different research groups, but this one in particular, the Shimshu Heru research team, consists of myself, Brother Sanjetti,
the cattle count team.
And
right.
This topic is very advanced.
We got to stop that, man, because the Shimshu Heru is the cattle count, and it's important to Kemet, and this is the Shimshu Heru research team telling us that it ain't important, but let's keep going.
There's no way I can cover even the beginnings of this in 20 minutes, and so as a result, we decided to write this text for people who want to understand what it is that we're talking about and how to prove your case and things of this nature. So it's called A Contribution to the Debate on the Meaning of the Place Name Kemet. This is a prelude to a larger work that we're doing on this subject. Next slide, please. So I want people to understand that, again, this is about linguistics. And historical comparative linguistics is akin to astrophysics. It's akin to quantum mechanics. It's mathematics. And so I don't know too many linguists here in the audience, so I'm not going to try to bog you down with all the technicalities of linguistic arguments.
Man, I swear he keep acting like he a linguist in front of qualified people, though. What's going on here?
Now he's also a physicist.
Golly, I'm just saying, like, you talking to these scholars at this conference, like, I don't think it's too many linguists in the crowd. So I'm not going to barge you down with linguistic jargon. Come on, bro. Hold on.
I told you about the magic. I told you about the magic that he's doing. But look what he's doing.
We about to see.
He doesn't put up Kemet He doesn't put up Shimshu Hor. He puts on Einstein's E is equals MC squared.
Let's watch it. He doesn't
put up Kemi.
Let's watch it.
Saying something when I make a claim in terms of the meaning of Kemi. It's just like this equation here, that E equals MC squared. Everyone's familiar with this. Energy equals mass times the speed of light squared, right? Well, this is at rest mass. Usually the real equation has a delta sign. The change in energy equals the change in mass times the speed of light squared. Next slide. But what people don't realize is that behind that equation, that's the reduced form. There's dozens of other equations. This is a picture from the only picture. This is a
oh my God, he came out the gate with a big fumble, dude.
His theory is on two chalkboards. So this is the first chalkboard, full of equations. Next slide. This is the second chalkboard, full of equations. So when you say E equals MC squared, is all of this. And if you don't understand all of this, you won't understand E equals MC squared. Next slide. Linguistics, as I said, is like mathematics. It basically is mathematics. And mathematics is the study of anything that obeys the rules of logic, using the rules of logic.
Six That's minutes, I ain't talked about Kemet.
When you're doing linguistics. It's about logic. It is also about patterns. Mathematics is the study of patterns. When you look at a formula, that's just an articulation of the rules that describe the patterns. Next equation. Next slide. So when I come out with my equation that Kemet means damp ground, irrigable land, riparian land, etc., just like the E equals MC squared, there's dozens of other formulas back there that gets me to this simplification.
Let's stop, because here's the definition of Kim that we've been looking for. It means wet. See, y'all? I didn't make that up. Kim means wet first. Yep. Second, irrigated, damp, or fresh. Okay? So, which cattle is Kemet? Is it the wet cattle, the irrigated cattle, the damp cattle, or the fresh cattle?
I thought we had the heads, just the Saab, the dessert, Deseret, and the Kemp. I thought we had those type of cattle. I didn't see them name a cattle being fresh or irrigated. I didn't see those type of cattle.
Anybody right? ever see them cattle? All y'all metal nature people in the chat, where is the wet cattle? When they talking about that? But let's continue.
No, no, stop right there. Before he even begins, he puts up Duro for Sumerian. So he doesn't even get to Kemp. I mean, he doesn't get to Africa yet. He's looking at Sumeria for relationships, and then he's applying it to C-Camp, right?
And here, I already tell you something. I don't know if I'm crazy, but I know a little Sumerian. And Key is not attached to the root of this word either. As you see, he got it with the period. He ain't attached to the root of this word, Duru. Ki Duru, I'm talking about, because how is Duru just a cognate for Kemet?
Well,
I just need
to word for Kuduro, and in my presentation, I break down what Kuduro is. But Kuduro is used in a text for vaginal sex and anal sex, and vaginal sex for wet and damp, right?
Interesting.
So I merely destroyed this in my presentation.
I would ask Chuck Morgan, who deals with the Sumerian, whether or not Ki is part of the root of this word. It seems to not be. You see Duro being the root, so Ki Duro is wet. Ki means earth. If I'm not, you know, Anunnaki, in one of these languages, I think Ki means earth, but I don't want to go there. Chuck Morgan is more well-versed for that.
Chuck has already destroyed that in a presentation that we did on Sineta, but I'm pretty sure he'd be happy to come back. But look at the pseudo-judo. So he doesn't go...
The wetland.
Yeah, he doesn't look at he only is looking at language words. He's not looking at the culture of the people. So he's forgot this is Shimshu Hor or cattle counters, right? But there he goes. But you can continue. Okay.
And so that you can't cover in 20 minutes. But this is my definition for those who don't know my position. And so we'll get into some things. So go next. So we understand that we are involved in intellectual warfare. And scholarship itself is intellectual warfare. And just like in warfare, there are certain things that you have to protect. There's certain things that you have to do. Next slide. For anyone who...
I swear to God. Why nobody didn't stop him? I mean, I'm just saying, bruh, you serious? You about to rhetoric your way out of this one? All right, keep going.
Wait, no, stop.
Yeah.
This is what I was talking about, Savage. Why anybody else in any other conference, they would have said, they would have stopped him. They would have stopped him. He has not talked about the subject in really directly in 7 minutes and 23 seconds, right? He has not talked, but he's talked about easy to MC Square. Now he's talking about warfare. Now he's talking about a German blitzkrieg. Blitzkrieg. So he's conflating this with methodology. Continue. Get your popcorn.
You know that when it's time for war, there are certain things that your enemy is going to always attack. So in modern days, you know, for those who don't know what blitzkrieg is, it's just an all-invasive attack at once. That's where you get the term blitz from in football. So if you know what a blitz is in football, you know what blitzkrieg is. So in modern, you know, the times of warfare, they have the Air Force, but they destroy your communications, they destroy your transportation, they destroy your military targets, your supplies. These are the things that you have to protect when you're at war, because that's what they're coming for first. Next slide.
People are like, let me go use the bathroom.
In scholarship, the first thing that they're going to attack is your methodology and your bibliography. Without a strong methodology, your conclusion is always going to be false. It's a proper way to do scholarship. And this is the thing that you always got to keep in mind for you young researchers coming up, that methodology is important. Next. And so we have a particular process called the scientific process, the scientific method. And so, you know, we ask a question, we do background research, we construct hypotheses, we test our hypotheses, and based on the conclusions of the hypotheses, we determine if, you know, the tests support our hypotheses or not. And so in linguistics, next slide please, you have the same type of thing, we call it the comparative method. So in order to fight scholastically, you have to know what type of war you're in and what weapons you will need in order to win the battle. So on this issue of Kemet, it's a linguistic argument, which means you have to have the tools, the weapons of linguistics to win the argument, to win the battle. Next slide. This is about the etymology and the meaning of the word Kemet. If any scholar comes before you and has not done an etymological analysis, they are wrong, they are guessing. They have a hypothesis. There's a process that you gotta go through. Since we are trying to understand the meaning and etymology of the word Kemet, we thus have entered the domain of linguistics and semantics and must use the tools, weapons of linguistics to answer the question, to win the war. Next slide. From the book, The Continuum Companion to the Historical Linguistics, Dr. Krish's chapter on etymology gives you what you're going to have to do etymological work. The big difference between Socrates, he was talking about the evolution of etymology and how we got to today. So start with
Smash.
Socrates.
What's up? What's up? Wait. I'm over here laughing on mute. What's up?
He went from easy glyph square with special relativity in Albert Einstein's work, right? So then after that, he goes to German warfare. So now he's giving us a lesson on etymology, right? By Thomas Krish, right? But he didn't even deal with his other argument that was in the slide before that Kim is equal black.
You're right. And so I was sitting here hoping that he gonna break down that in a minute. So I'm giving him a chance. He got like 7 more minutes. So here we go.
The Greeks. The big difference between Socrates' approach and the modern etymology is that nowadays one tries to argue systematically in all strata, in phonology, in morphology, in the semantics, pragmatics, and also extra-linguistically in philology, in culture. One also takes into account historical developments. If one wants to be a productive and successful expert in etymology, one has to thoroughly study all areas mentioned. Next slide. That means, since we're talking about the etymology and the meaning of Kemet, whatever scholar comes to you in front of your face, they have to present something from all 6 areas here, because that's how you do etymology. So, at question and answer, ask any one of us in any one of these areas to provide proof of their claim. And let's see, you know, what happens. Next slide. In the 19th and 20th centuries, these scholars, the comparative method based on strict morphological, phonological, and lexical comparison was developed. The most important output of this research was the discovery of sound laws, which mediate between cognate languages, their respective older stages, and their common predecessors. This research, in turn, relies on good etymologies of words that exemplify the sound laws and the regularities of word formation. So the first step that you would have to do as an etymologist was to set up your sound laws. Next slide. You set up your sound laws by certain comparisons. So I'm going to do a quick case study. So Dr. Mario Beatty, some years ago, did a paper and a presentation, I think at ASCAP, called Hesse, Wretch, the Anatomy of Informed Relations Concept.
See, he should have left us out.
Hesse means weak, feeble, mm-hmm. cowardly, humble of rank, mean of conduct, vile of enemy, speech, wretch, coward. This picture is from an old video that I shot at the University of Houston when... This is way back in like...
All those words.
This is old. So if you see a video of Dr. Beatty with hair teaching about Dr. Diop, that's me behind the camera. So anyway, next slide, please. And so the controversy is that they really don't understand the meaning of the word Hesse. But linguistics helps us answer that fully and more accurately. And so the first thing you have to do is set up the sound laws. So what I have here is what I call Chikam Egyptian, the Yoruba language, and the sound correspondences on the right. And so when you go through each of these, I have it highlighted in red so you can get it, that these correspond with each other in each language. So I have set it up to where wherever there's an S in Egyptian, there's going to be a sh sound in Yoruba. Next slide. It's the same thing here.
All right, let's keep going. Sorry to stop, but I'm letting y'all know I'm confused.
No, but why is he doing that with Kemet?
Yeah, I'm he trying to maybe go at Mario Beatty in his last, here go the last 5 minutes, let's go.
So when you say was is the same thing in Yoruba as ashe in these different words. The sound correspondences match. Now in Yoruba, they lose the W and they lose the, for those who transliterate metanature, the capital A, which is the nasalizer who are cheers, a type of R. This is important, next, because reflexes of this root, this she root, means to offend, to miss, sin, an unprecedented mistake, and accidental.
See, the problem is, he was supposed to do this with Kemet.
Yes.
You feel me? You doing this with another word at another presentation that a person in front of you presented and trying to show how he was wrong on that other word. Well, hopefully you tied this in smooth, my brother.
No, he don't.
She mistaken. She to misbehave. Ashishe, a mistake indeed, a deed which is wide off the mark. She showed to speak wrongly, to make it slip of the tongue. All of these are different variations of that common root, which gives us next the cognate for the word wretched. in Egyptian, which is Hasid. So, you know, as I gave it before, so we have two cognates, two forms of the same word, Hesi and Was, or Waset, who's a miserable person, a wretch. And so Yoruba, we say Oshi, wretchedness, Shoshi, to be wretched. This is the first thing that you would do in a linguistic analysis in terms of setting up your sound meaning correspondences. This eliminates chance. That's what the scientific method is designed to do, to eliminate chance and human bias in research method. So we can
probably, yeah, but it's all hypothetical.
To be off path, to be misguided, to be misdirected. Because it talks about being
hypothetical. Right
off the mark. So now when you do a philological analysis, next slide, and you go back into the text, stuff starts to make more sense. So Dr. Beatty spoke on Tefi, you know, of Wala, and this particular thing in the first intermediate period, you know, where he says, and on whomsoever I laid my hand, no harm could approach him, because my reasoning was so expert and my plans were so excellent, but every ignorant person, every wretch who opposed me, I retaliated against him for his deeds. The way that they use Hesi is to be in opposition, to be off path. So if I laid a path for you and you go against what I laid out as a parent, as a government, as a teacher for your students, they have committed chesed. And so this is why in the Ptah Hotep text, it has a similar feeling. And so everybody who's opposed to us that is off the mark is chesed. Next slide. And so from my last presentation at ASCAP, where I dealt with ma'az, the linguistic analysis of ma'az shows that it's a word that means to walk on the right path. When you talk about truth.
So he dealt with every word but Kim, huh?
Comes from the literal word for foot and walking correctly on the right path. So Hesi is opposite of ma'az. Ma'az is to walk on the correct path, to use the right method. Hesi, in fact, is not. It's to be off path. Next slide. So I say, the takeaway from this, etymology requires a systematic analysis in six critical research areas: phonology, morphology, semantics, pragmatics, philology, culture, and history. An analysis of the etymology and meaning of the word Kemet requires a scientific process called the historical comparative method. If one's analysis on Kemet doesn't include a complete analysis in all six areas mentioned in the historical comparative method, then one's research is essentially hesi, weak, vile, wretched, off path, misguided.
Oh, that's how he's trying to do?
The opposite of ma'at, the correct method. It can only lead to isfet, disorder, chaos, and wrongdoing. There's a reason why we have a process of scholarship. And every single person who is trying to answer this question neglects the scientific method, neglects the historical comparative method. This is a linguistic question. And so that should have been the first thing. This is how you determine what the root and the meaning of a word is, through the historical comparative method. And so I have some bonus slides, but that's my time. Thank you.
Seriously?
Seriously?
Hold on.
Okay, so.
Hold on, we gotta give Dr. Mario Beatty his bounce back, but you can give your, say what you have to say.
It doesn't deserve any of our time, except for we need to put that presentation on Front Street. He didn't put Kemet in big letters. That's what he was supposed to be dealing with. He's talking about the methodology, and you got to go and do these six things, and it's like blitzkrieg and intellectual war. And then he uses the case of Hesse. He never uses the case of Kemet. He has his book in front of him. He doesn't pull out anything from his book, which we bought later. And his book that we bought later doesn't make his case for what he actually said, because he doesn't do the historical comparative linguistics, which is hypothetical anyway, right? It's hypo because Kemet is not, ancient Egypt's language has not been reconstructed anyway. So the sound, we really are not doing real sound correspondences, but it's a start, but it's not a language. So I want to put his presentation on pseudo killers and on your channel, and we want to go through this shit blow by blow.
We don't even have to, because Dr. Beattie put hands on that. I mean, he just came off the top of the head and was like, this boy coming at me, he's supposed to be talking about Kemet. So thanks to Shotgun to Go Kemet for having this up. Now we're going to watch Dr. Beattie respond to that.
Well, first of all, it's my video.
Okay, shout out to Brother Reggie. But
I'm just saying, I recorded it. So right, so he didn't know or didn't give me credit, but I recorded it.
Yeah,
right,
he didn't know. Well, thank you for recording. Here we go. Did it stop? Did it pause?
Following my presentation. Oh, here we go. You know, we've spent a lot about what Kemet is. The title of my presentation is Why Reconceptualizing National Identity. Next slide. I'm going to dedicate this presentation to Sheikh Anta Jofi. And next slide. And in the 1974 UNESCO symposium, Sheikh Anta Jofi actually gives credit to deciphering what the word Kemet means. He actually gives credit to another African. This other African, he says, is Susu Nsugan, who was to compile this part of the present chapter. So I give credit to this brother too for this particular piece. Next slide. At the UNESCO conference, just a brief review. At the UNESCO conference, we read the proceedings of the unabridged volume of the General History of Africa, Volume 2. There is a debate, many debates, but there is a debate around the word Kemet. But the main protagonist was a brother from the Sudan, Abdel Gadir Abdallah. And Abdallah, I kind of feel like we're recreating the 1974 UNESCO conference. Because Abdallah said at that conference that the word Kim didn't mean black. And that was what started the whole tete-a-tete at the UNESCO symposium on the issue of Kemet.
So we got Abdallah coming back in the image of Asar, huh?
Mm-hmm. That's correct.
And so immediately after he said that, a French Egyptologist, Serge Saint-Laurent, intervened. And Serge Saint-Laurent intervened and said, no. Kim does mean black. And so Serge Saint-Laurent and Jean Leclerc, their debates with Sheikh Anta Jofi were over issues of race and culture, but not an issue of whether or not the word Kim meant black.
Exactly. That was my point.
Next slide. By way of conclusion, so if I don't complete my time, I'm going to give you my conclusions up front.
Okay. That's when you start gassing.
By way of conclusion, the word Kemet refers to a novel ethno-geopolitical national marker of identity that was primarily forged in the cauldron of the internal contradictions and politics of what is referred as the first intermediate period. Novel in two fundamental ways. One, the innovation of a unitary concept of a nation, and two, the political need to more rigidly distinguish themselves as a nation of people, which is clearly shown in a new hyper discourse around borders, Tosh, internally and externally, initially and principally directed against the people from Western Asia in the first intermediate period. Next slide. So, how do we know? So, you know, Asar, you know, gave some examples of my work, and I'm going to give some examples of your work. How do we know that Asar Imhotep means Osiris who comes in peace? How is it that we know that? We know that through a process of historical evolution within the Kemetic language, where Asar is Usire in Coptic. Ii which is to come, continues all the way to Compton. Hotep is a word that continues from the beginning all the way to Compton.
He got
hands on him.
Asar's method, unfortunately, is not a historical comparative method. It's an ahistorical comparative method. It's ahistorical in the sense that what Asar does is that he wants to bypass the historical evolution of the Egyptian language that ends in Coptic. And so because he does not feel that Coptic is a part of the Egyptian language, he feels that it's a separate language. So what Asar does in his comparative method is that he goes into other areas and he doesn't go through Coptic. He goes around it. And that's where Obinga's method is the correct method. And the correct method is actually a free translation. Tepeseb means atop the county. How do we know that? Through Coptic. So, as a result, every time you bypass Coptic, you are implicitly saying that Metu-Netcher has not been deciphered.
Bang, bang.
In your method. Because when you make translations of any text, ask yourself, how is it that we get Khenu means residence? How do we get to that? Are we guessing? Or is there a long historical evolution that ends in Coptic? And so this is what's at stake. So I'm giving this example up here from Jaroslav Czerny's Coptic Etymological Dictionary. This is the English version. I'll come to Ogden Golay's article in a minute. But Ogden, in his piece, he gives the French version, Werner Bissichel, Dictionnaire Etymologique de la Langue Copte. But in both languages, when you see, I don't have my clicker up here, but when you see Kimon become black, Kame black, and you see it in Demotic there, and then it has Keme, black land, Egypt. That means, and then of course, in the Vertebu that you like to cite, the earliest reference to Kim that the Vertebu gives is from the Second Dynasty, where the determinative on Kim is the horse, falcon, on a standard. And how does he translate it? The black horse.
Bang.
In the Virgin. So from the earliest attestation, from the Second Dynasty onward, we actually see Kim meaning black. So you ask, the question is, how do we get to this? That is, that Kim as a root has a long evolution inside the Kemetic, language. Next. Reggie gave a text from the pyramid text, and this text is actually from the text of the pyramid of Pepi I. And the line is here, his transcription is in the second line there. Aha ek kinti kimetiu hapi, and then east. Next line. This is James Allen's translation of this. You shall stand at the four of the dual flagpole shrines as men. You shall stand at the four of those of black land as the Apis. That is that Allen is translating, because Allen is translating that as a Nesby adjective, and it's proper. That's what you see there. But it's an interesting parallel here in terms of what you see, because as Reggie said, there's a couple of points that Reggie's making very strong here. But as Reggie said, the Apis bull is not just a sacred bull, but it's a black bull. So when you see here, those of the black land as Apis, it's actually an emphasis on the fact that it's black. But the interesting thing is that with Pepi the First, we're in the Sixth Dynasty, and this is kind of what I want to talk about today, is that we're in the Sixth Dynasty, The reference by Ogden Gole, which I'm coming to in a minute, in terms of the historical reference, this implies, Kemet to you implies a Kemet. But the problem is that we only see it in the pyramid text. But it implies an old kingdom origin point.
See, this is why I want Dr. Mario Beatty to see what we find now and to focus on what we have. Hey, wait a minute, Dr. Beatty, because we got Kemet to you. Again, it appears before we got Kemet, as he's saying, but he's saying it implies an old kingdom origin place. I'm saying, oh, it might imply an ethnonym before it was a geonym or what have you, toponym. Well,
see, someone like you would be a person that could go to an ASCAC conference and present, right? And Dr. Mario Beatty would listen and learn and have comments. He's a great professor. He's actually a great professor. Look at his, look at the way that he's teasing this thing out, right? It doesn't, but what I'm saying is you live and die on your citations and what you've read. If you introduce something else, then a person could actually change directions, right? Or run over it. So, but look at his style, his analysis. He's not being mean to Asar, but he's devastating Asar, right? Anyway, you can continue. But yes, I would like you to see your work.
Social descriptive. Next slide. But the issue is that when we look at a text by Nigel Strugwick, text from the pyramid age. Nigel Strugwick, this is the most comprehensive compilation of texts in the English language that you can read of the Old Kingdom. And I've looked at every one of these texts. And when you look at all of these texts, what you see is that Kemet is not a word that is used in the Old Kingdom to describe.
Okay, there you go.
Right.
Their land. And it's quite interesting. So that there is something that is going on. We can't fully see what is going on in the Second Dynasty all the way up until the beginning of the Middle Kingdom. But there is something there. Next slide.
I'm going to stop right there because that's what we're working on. We're working on the part where you say there is something there. All the work we've been doing is the question the scholar has right here about the use of Kemet to you before the geographic gnome Kemet, I mean, the whole place Kemet was even a thing. And so I just want to point that out to people that we ain't saying there's something there. This is probably where we could enter the conversation.
That's correct.
Some of our conversation is actually, some of what I've seen is actually an engagement with the work of Ogden Gole here, and an article that he wrote, Kemet and Other Egyptian Terms for Their Land. And Ogden was a professor at New York University. I actually worked with him when I was scholar in residence here at NYU. And I actually have all of his files that were thrown away in the trash by NYU. that's another story. But Ogden in this, next slide. Well, before I come back to Ogden, I'm going to give this presentation as a shout out to my master teacher, Theophilo Binker. And, you know,
bars.
Dom DeMarco has always taught me, many have taught me, to let the ancestors speak for themselves.
Stuff like this.
Bars. Let the elders speak for themselves. And so, I'm not going to, in terms of what Kemet is, I'm going to read Obinga and my translation of Obinga in French.
And see, he addressing the topic, man.
And this is a work, a relatively recent work that Obinga has published. And this is part of a debate. It's a book called Le Sang de la Lutte contre l'Africanisme Eurocentriste, the meaning of the struggle against Eurocentrism. African. And this is an excerpt from this book in a debate that he held or in print with Marc Etienne who is the curator of the Egyptian collection at the Louvre Museum. So I'm just going to read you what he wrote in response to Marc Etienne in this debate, which actually resolves some of the issues that we're talking about. Next slide. And he's quoting Marc Etienne here. As a result, the ancient Egyptians were black African like all other natives of the African continent. Of course, there are blacks not only in Africa, but in South India and Melanesia, for example. Marc Etienne has not yet mastered the Egyptian language written in hieroglyphs. And now he's quoting Etienne. The name of Egypt, Kemet, is often translated erroneously by Sheikh Antajok as the country of the blacks, with grammatical errors added by T. Obinga Passam. Next slide. This translation is based on the distinction, this is still Etienne, this translation is based on the distinction made by the Egyptian text between one part called the Black Land, Ta Kim, and it's using Ta as a definite article, Ta Kim, that is to say the cultivated valley in reference to the color of the Nile soil, and the other part, the Red Land, that is to say the desert. The word Kim means to be complete, in the sense of completed, achieved, which refers to the well-attested concept of the unity of Egypt, materialized by the union of the two lands, Upper and Lower Egypt, but also the unity of the country as a divine eye with perfect integrity. He's quoting Marc Etienne here. Next. And now here's Obinga's voice. Marc Etienne wanders. And it is a serious error for a quote-unquote curator of Egyptian antiquities at the Louvre Museum in Paris. What he writes does not make any sense. Sheikh Antajok translated Kemet by the land of the blacks in which work, which page? I have advanced this translation with grammatical errors in which work, which page? Why lie constantly, you Eurocentric Africans?
Ooh, hands on him.
Now he's giving his demonstration. If Ta Kim means black land, and if you consider Kim to be complete, completed, achieved in the translation of this expression, Ta Kim, what is then the final translation? Something like this, complete black land completed. That is, here the word Kim has a double meaning, black and to be complete at the same time. Marc Etienne is totally wrong. He ignores the existence of synonyms and homonyms in Egyptian. He confuses everything with incredible frivolity. Next slide. Here are the facts ignored by Marc Etienne. Kim noir, adjective. The hieroglyph of the owl is employed as a phonetic complement. Kim, to complete, to be complete. You see the determinative of the papyrus rolled up tied and sealed. At the end there, conveying abstract notion. Thus, there exists two words, Kim, which are homonyms, but not synonyms. Adjective black and the verb to be complete. Next slide. They are different at both the lexical and grammatical level for all Egyptologists of the world, with the exception of the erudite curator of the Louvre, Marc Etienne. Next slide. What is the authentic Egyptian text that has or presents Ta Kim, black land, to designate Egypt? There is no text. That's what Obinga is saying. Like, why are you even, you know, coming at me? This designation is a pure invention of our Egyptological scholar who should avoid the scientific lie. Marc Etienne is a dishonest man in regards to scientific research. The well-attested concept of the unity of Egypt, materialized by the union of the two lands, Upper and Lower Egypt, is not Kim to be complete, but it is Sema to unite and also Chess to unite. Everyone knows. Next slide. The Sema Tawi rite, unification of the two lands, is known by the beginner studying Egyptology. Marc Etienne can now learn it. Next slide. In addition, the Egyptian lexicon gives the following. Kemet, the Pays Noir, the black country in English. Kemet, les gens de Pays Noir, les hommes et les femmes du pays noir, les habitants du pays noir. That is the Egyptians of pharaonic times. That is the men and women of the black country, the people of the black country, the inhabitants of the black country. The inhabitants of black Africa are black African. The inhabitants of the black country are blacks. It is the same reasoning. The Melanesians are precisely black islanders. Melas, black, and Nessos, Dorian, Nassos, island in Greek. Next slide. In his work, Ogden Gollay makes a distinction between two concepts. One concept is Jeru, limits, and the other concept is Tashu, borders. And Jeru is a concept of limits that is primarily in the spiritual sphere. It deals with time and space on a broad level. But when the Kemites employ Tash, they employ that in a more geopolitical sense. And what is missed by Ogden Gollay in his article is that he doesn't present the historical context of the origin of those concepts. Next slide. And that is that what Ogden doesn't do in that article is that he doesn't give a precise origin to the discourse around Tash, borders. This is a very important point in this discussion. There is a hypersensitivity of the concept of Tashu borders in Egyptian text that begins in the first intermediate period, which is not captured or even historically contextualized properly in Gollay's narrative frame. And I just give one example here, and I give a text where you can read many examples from for yourself in Jose Galán, Victory and Border. Approach me, Keti. I shall make a storm over the province. My rule is Neket, after I have made my Tash as far as Wadi Hesi. Stella of the overseer of Jari, reporting Intef's words addressed to Keti. So the point is here is that there is, when the ancient Egyptians are in this context, spending over, well over 100 years of fighting each other, there is now a fractured national consciousness. And that fractured national consciousness internally is playing out with this hypersensitivity of borders. Against themselves, initially, this goes into my discourse on Hasi also that you talked about. Everything is linked. Next slide. So as Asar has rightly said in a presentation, is that in the Old Kingdom, primarily when we look at administrative text, what we can see is we see Tawi, the two lands, we see the two river banks, the two riparian lands with the irrigated canals, and then we see Hanu, the residents. Next slide. But somewhere, this is from Ogden. Ogden says, somewhere around the period when Egypt was once more reunified under the rule of Dynasty 11 monarch Nehep, Pet Ra, Menchuhotep II, the terms Kemet, the Black Land, and Ta Meri, the Beloved Land, first made their appearance. And so what Ogden does in his article is, next slide. What Ogden does in his article is that he distinguishes between what he calls non-literary texts and literary texts, and to try to make this point. And every time that Ogden, this is an inference being made by Egyptologists, that is that when they see Kemet translated in contrast to Deshret, when they see that, they are translating Black Land. And it has a connotation for them of quote unquote soil, the soil. When they're not seeing that, then they're translating it as Egypt. That is, as something much broader than this. And so Asar makes a point in a presentation that I saw that when you see the determinatives of an irrigated canal on the back of Kemet as opposed to the town or settlement, what Asar said in one of his presentations was that those two determinatives are interchangeable. No, they're not.
Ooh.
Those two determinatives are in different semantic universes. So if you see an irrigated canal on the back of Kemet, then yes, It is appropriate, it's quite appropriate to translate that as the black land. The black irrigated land, actually. But if you don't see that, you can't make that translation. When you see the town determinative on Kemet, you cannot make that translation. And it is not inferred or implied. Next slide. So I have some work to do myself because I did a little bit of work at Johns Hopkins. And I said, because all of these texts that Ogden gave were very localized in a particular region called the Wadi Hammamat. And everyone knows is that these inscriptions are interesting because many of them lack definitive clarity in terms of the presentation and depiction of glyphs. And I said, I'm just going to take one text from Ogden, and I'm going to just look at how the word Kemet is actually represented in one of his major citations. Because I don't accept what they say. I always want to have reference, as this is my teaching from Obeying. Give me the original text. I don't want to see you. I don't want to see your mistakes. Egyptologists make mistakes all the time. And here I don't even have the original text, but I'm actually closer because this is a hieroglyphic facsimile. So I actually tried to get the original text, but I couldn't. We actually need to see all of these texts actually before we even make a final determination on this. But what I want to show you is here. This right here.
Yes, sir.
Right here. This is, quote unquote, their word for Kemet in one of the texts that Ogden Gilead cites. You tell me, if you, Mpundishi, anyone in here who is taking the language, you tell me if that glyph looks like the Kemet glyph. You tell me yes or no. The inference that's being made is that because of the phonetic complement is the owl, that must be Kemet. I don't see Kemet in there. In fact, the angle is not there on the Kemet glyph. And then it dips. It has a little dip at the end. I'm not even sure what this glyph is. This is a major text that he cited. So as we're making these points, as we're making these arguments, we need to actually look at the original text. That's a historical method. Next slide. And I'm going to go quick. Next slide. I'm going to skip this. And so I'm going to end this presentation on instruction from Mary Kyre. Brother Reggie has mentioned this also. But I wanted to talk about this text a lot. Strengthen your borders, your frontier patrols. A wretched is he who desires the land of a neighbor. Troops will fight troops as the ancestors foretold. Kemet fought in the graveyard, destroying tombs and vengeful destruction. What is going on here, folks, is that, and I disagree with Ogden, because it is not Menkaure II that is creating the concept of Kemet for the nation. That is, that in the process of the ancient Egyptians fighting themselves during the first intermediate period, this term has evolved, kind of like Cassie. This term has evolved from a descriptive kind of social concept, and it has taken on a different geopolitical connotation in the environment of the first intermediate period that culminates with Menkaure II, but does not begin with Menkaure II. And what they're saying is that on an ethnic, on a geopolitical level, that we're the black country. And they're saying that to reaffirm who they were as a people, and also in their principal opposition of Western Asia in this text. Next slide. Lo, Dr. Carruthers quotes this all the time. Lo, the miserable Asiatic. He is wretched because of the place he's in. Short of water, bare of wood. His paths are many and painful because of mountains. He does not dwell in one place. Food propels his legs. He fights since the time of Horus. I made Lord Egypt attack them. I captured their inhabitants. I seized their cattle until the Asiatics abhorred Kemet. This is where Ogden is translating Kemet as Egypt. That is, that it goes beyond talking about the quote-unquote soil. And that's what the town determinative. And as Gardner translates this determinative in his hieroglyphic sign book, is that Beklif is implies an inhabited region. That is, you're talking about the country and its people. And so what they are talking about when they say Kemet as the black country, they are talking about both the country and the people. Thank you very much.
That was dope. Hold on.
Next panel, folks. We got to be on time.
1 second. First. Let me stop this. Shit like that. Yeah, hold on. Hey, y'all, give me 1 second. Hey, Asar, Reggie, y'all got anything to say about those presentations?
Hey, real quick, my teacher of mine, Dr. Mario Beatty, somebody who I serve under Association for the Study of Classical African Civilization, allowed me to engage in this discourse for the public on Kemet, and bring in Sar, let me present, and he presented last as the president of the association. As many of you can see that I have the respect of scholars, right? I did the homework, I cited the work, right? One day you'll see my presentation, which is much of what I've been talking about on this channel, but he totally dissected Asar's method and say that it was ahistorical, right, from the get. And then he cited other people like who were actually scholars or PhDs, and for the same era, he talked about basically what Smash does on this show: go to the primaries. We don't want to see your mistakes, Asar. We don't need to see your mistakes. Let's look at the original material, and we could decide it for ourselves and build analysis. So, Hey man, I don't get my, Smash, I don't get my flowers, man. I mean, I'm debating with, I'm not talking about particularly Asar and them, but I end up debating with knuckleheads that haven't done the work. And I've been doing the work for a long, 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 long time. And this whole thing is because I wrote an abstract to ASCAC properly to engage them to have this debate and to begin to settle it for that time period. Doesn't mean that the issue is closed, but the Asar and the Shimshu Hor point is closed because they haven't done the work. They just haven't done the work. So their issue is closed, actually, right? Now some of the new work can go on, but I just want to tell you formally, without all their fireworks and backflips and you don't know enough, their whole book, the issue was closed. I'll stop.
Asar?
Man, it's true. Saber Reggie, you've been doing the work for a long time. You, like I always tell people, you sit at the footsteps of Dr. Leonard Jeffries, Professor James Smalls. People don't know how intricate and how close to their families you are, right? So even like the late Harry Kafra, people don't even respect him. One of Dr. Raketi Yaman's main pupils. But watching the presentation is... I watched the guy kind of run away from the discussion he came to discuss, with no disrespect. He never addressed the word or the noun phrase as we know it as Kemet in depth. Why would you come put on a presentation about methodology and Tep Hiseb if you didn't come to do Tep Red? Y'all go look up Tep Red. It just, and then I remember, because everybody knows when I put up the EMC squared equals Netcha, they turn around and he throw this in the presentation. Energy equals MC squared, which has nothing to do with the discussion you're having on the topic. It was almost like he was saying, I don't want to discuss it in this format. I'm not built for this particular situation. Let's do it over here. Let's talk behind closed doors so I can actually get some, you know, some knowledge and try to reframe my argument. Aside from that, just looking at what we saw right there, the breakdown of Kemet, the history Mario Beatty has with knowing a scholar got kicked out of the school based off of his work and showing how he disagrees, why he disagrees, knowing to go to the Coptic initially, knowing where to take the discussion formally. You watch Mario Beatty just crunch his man. He punished his man. And when you do that, there's not a whole lot you can do if you don't have the information to refute it. And there is no information to refute what he stated, because he covered his riparian notion and then backed it with the fact that, like we've been showing, Kim Ware means great black. Before it meant bitter lake. And to the people, which you've been seeing us on this channel, as Smash has already pointed out, Saber Reggie's already pointed out, we just covered the primary resource that shows Kemet to you. So it's possible that there's a people that was saying we're Kemet to you before we had Kemet. And so when you guys, when you see this type of work right here, this is when you give your salute, you know, I don't need your flowers. Just support the work, peep out game, and get the real understanding. That's all we come on here is to clarify for you. Smash done had a rap career. I done had a rap career and a fight career. Saber Reggie been around at the greats for years. We on here just to edify you on specific topics so that you get that same understanding we get and get an even more in-depth understanding. Go beyond our work. But actually go do the work. You listening to guys who you got ghost words in your book, man. What are you doing?
Hey, yo, set 12, get yourself in this forum. You log in because you seem to be a fan. You want to talk about the comparative method, right? You want to talk about the comparative method. You get on and you since you seem to be a fan of his, get yourself on and you explain the comparative method and explain why Assar in a national conference, an international conference, did not use the comparative method in the context of Kemet. You get yourself on, right? And then you say that you start talking about they don't Mario Beatty and them don't know comparative linguistics. If you listen to the presentation, it's not about comparative linguistics, right? It's about etymology, right? And there's many, many components. Dr. Beatty gave examples. What examples did Saw Imhotep give? None. So yeah, listen,
he was talking
man.
About blitzkrieging. He was talking about blitzkrieg.
So if you can't get yourself in and show us a comparative method of Kemet, which Saw has not done. He didn't do it in his contributions. He skipped that. He talked about other terms. And then, yo, let's miss me with that. Then miss me with that. If you can't come on as a student, I want you as a student of his to come on and show what you learned. You're not going to do it. Sorry, Smash.
Our brother Sat 12. It's good to pom-pom your favorites. That's not a bad thing. I'm just saying, you know, they watched Rocky lose to Clubber Lang. Remember the Adrian? He had pom-pom. The thing is, when you're outclassed, you're outclassed. And it's not even about outclassing him. What it is about is your discussion, your argument is incorrect right now. Go back to the drawing board so you can correct it. It's very simple. It's very simple.
It's the fans. See, Assar, you know, Assar is one thing.
he has a right to push his hypothesis, and we have a right to critique his hypothesis, right? But the people who are fans, that's the problem. We have people who believe in people, right? And now I want to know, if you believe in that person, show me how you are convinced that he's right. I want to see your work, right? Yes, true. I spent a lot of time with the elders. I spent a lot, but I could convince you of my work. I'm not a fanboy of them. I look at their work, and then I do the work to make sure that I agree with their work or I don't agree with the work. So you come on SAT 12 instead of muddying the chat with your BS. Show us your intellect. I want to see you break down the comparative linguistics method and use it in the term of Kemet. You can't do that, man. Miss me with that.
Yeah, facts. But, you know, like I said, don't let, I never let, like, because you're going to, like I said, you're going to have your favorites all the time. You know, people just, they move like that. They just, they're intrigued by certain people.
Yeah, but so that's us being savages. That's us being cults.
You just got groupies. You know,
but that's cult behavior and savages. That's not acceptable in academia. It's not acceptable in our work.
No, without question. It's not like you get any extra, you know. No one's going to pat his back in the scholastic world because of that. But you got Raider fans. They're 1-3. I'm a Steelers fan. We're 1-3 at the moment. And then we got 7 Super Bowls. So you trying to look back at something that he did before. But the simple fact is, if you can't refute the work and the work that you presented is not only plagiarized, faulty, and incorrect, and you stand behind that, you're just wrong on a particular topic. Well, and that's what they are right now.
Sat wrote something else. So me and Sat is cool. Right. Because because the good brother actually made a positive comment. But so I take it back from SAT 12. But I want to say the other people who are capping, you are responsible now for showing the historical comparative linguistics, not your God Asor. Right. Not your God Asor. You are. If you can't show it, then you either a bad student or your teacher was bad. So you choose bad student, you can't understand it, or your teacher was bad, he couldn't teach it and wield it. But peace to you, Sat 12. Sorry, Asar. With Seer in cock, because I can't call you Asar in cock.
Are you the big brother? The question, I guess, from here with everything that we have, because obviously we're going to start to push. You know, Smash is going to push that Kemet to you. You're about to push the Kyle the Bull. I'm pushing Black Land and touching on some things that are ancient as well. All these things, all these terms come to Black and Kim. And to address some of the questions, somebody has said, our brother Fitz said, he never addressed what Black means. But we've never heard what wet means. What is riparian? I mean, if we don't know what water is or what the color Black is, we're at a loss. And I'm sure the people of that time didn't have to do that. They knew what the color Black was. And they knew what the color red was.
And the Emmy dude, what they failed to do is ever translate Kim. So put it on record. Is the translation of Kim always Black? Or is the translation of Kim wet? If it is wet, W-E-T, then you have to show the text where wet applies in Kemet in the text. That's what Smash was doing earlier. You are going to have the root, if the root is not Kim, and Kim does not, if the root is I-6, and you're saying that the root does not mean Black, or associated to Black, then you have to show the Texas where wet is where you could use wet in the context of those words. Weti. So it's not Kemet to you, the black people, or the people of the black bull, or any of that. You have to show the people of the wet, right? Yeah, the people of the riparian.
Absolutely. And then you have to go to Emmy, because the owl. Remember, the owl is Emmy, which is associated with death and a few other things, and bad luck. And when we get it, there's a very interesting article that I've been quoting from and pulling from. And once we get to the Emmy and we seal them together, it's pretty much going to be a wrap. And here go to where's the article for Emmy? It's right over here too.
Right, but you have to make sure that you're applying. Usually the word Emmy appears, the word Emmy appears in the beginning, right?
It's the root word of the owl. Watch.
Look, I just got off the phone. What y'all talking about? I'm not Reggie up in here taking
Reggie ready to choke.
I don't know what y'all heard something about Emmy. I don't want to go there. What y'all talking about, man?
Oh, the owl. The owl and the word.
Oh, y'all talking about M-E-R or something else?
No. Kim, when we go Kim and we look at each glyph.
Okay, my bad. I thought you know what I thought you was talking about, Reggie.
No, I was. See? We was smashed. We was going in. It's just that a saw softened it. He's hiding it. But I do want to say that M is a phonetic complement. So I don't want to necessarily. I want to be cautious that it could just be a phonetic complement of Kim itself. So
let's take a look.
Instead of it being a separate word, but go ahead.
If we take a look, International Journal of History and Cultural Studies, she goes real in depth on the owl. She even connects it to Neith, and she connects it to Horus.
Sure. But in the context of the word
Kemet,
in the context of the word Kemet, you will have to rule out that it's a phonetic complement to make sure. I'm not saying that it's not related in the context of the culture, the people, and gives for better understanding. And I think that that's what you're saying. But in straight grammar, the owl in Kemet is a phonetic complement.
Yeah, well, it's a noun, right? It's a noun next to an adjective, and the adjective comes before it because it's in the vocative case, and it's a feminine genitive. So absolutely right. But when we look at why they would have chose these particular words and what they break down to, she goes in depth.
Hey, I got to get ready to close it down, though. I was just on the phone handling some business, got a few other things to do. I appreciate y'all for helping make it a wonderful, powerful stream. Let's, you got some words in closing about how she go in depth or about anything?
We'll say that for another time.
Appreciate y'all. Yo, we gonna get on that guest in that Kim document. Can you hit me off, Reggie?
Yes, I will. Good brother.
Yeah, I'm gonna get a good reading of that tonight, and maybe we'll be able to revisit that tomorrow. Yo, thank y'all. You got some final words, Reggie?
Let's just continue to do the work. That's about it. I'm not trying to be ugly to Asar and his team. I just think that people have to do the work for themselves, and when they do it, the work, then they'll see what the truth is. Don't let nobody lead you and try to sound all fly, because you saw him up there. You saw him on an international conference, and he didn't handle his business. He didn't handle his business. And it's on record. And it's on my page, and I filmed it, and it's going to be on there until the end of the earth, right? Until YouTube kicks me off. But that was your presentation, Asar, in the national conference on the subject that you decided to present on, and that was your work, and it wasn't good work. It just wasn't good work. It wasn't good work at all, right? And so you got corrected, and there you go. And then guess what? You lose the argument. You have lost the argument because you went to a conference and you ain't handle your business. So you could cry and say, brother Reggie's not smart enough, ain't did the work. And yo, on that computer science degree, I need to see your degree. I need to see your degree in computer science, bro. Not in information science. Information science is not computer science, bro. Let's do the root word. The root word is computer science, not information science. You want to see my degree, Fosse?
What are we doing? I missed a lot of the show. I must have missed it.
Here go, y'all.
Here go.
Right?
University of New York.
Computer science. Yo, I need.
Hold on, you got to put that back up because I got to click on your screen. We couldn't see it. Go back. They didn't see it.
Here we go. Hold up, y'all. Hold up.
See, every time you talk, we can't see it. Hold on. Okay, we see it. Now we're going to see what words you photoshopped.
We need these. Bring them out.
Okay, so, yo, not only that. It's not only that. I can show you the bulletin in which I got the ceremony.
Hold on. Sorry, showing here. So we want to get everybody photoshops up on the screen. Let me get your Photoshop work. Because, you know, somebody said it was me who, I mean... Hold on, I can't show your screen big. I'm trying to show your screen big, but it's showing two screens. Hold on, just one view. I'm going to go, I guess, immerse. Nope, I don't know what I'm doing. All right, we can see you, though, but we couldn't see it on the big screen. I don't know how I messed that up. But it's all good. Yeah,
A degree don't mean nothing, really. But don't lie. So if you ain't got a degree in computer science, if you got it in word processing, information science, right? If you got it in that, then fine. But if you want to say you're a computer scientist and if you got a degree in computer science, I apologize to you. I will apologize to you. However, if you don't have a degree in computer science and you didn't take university physics, chemistry, biology, and mathematics, you didn't take differential equation, you ain't take linear algebra, you ain't take Boolean algebra. Those are requirements, right? If you didn't do that and you ain't take university physics, chemistry, and biology, what you did was took the remedial version, the associated version,
but not university.
That's all right, Smash, because you're not saying it.
You say it, exactly. You're not claiming it, but you do a better
you're
work.
You're not saying it. The point is, if you get up there and say you got a degree in computer science, if you got a degree in computer science, show your degree. I can show my degree in 5 minutes. Show it over and over again. And I did that in 1988. 88, I got a degree in computer science. So listen, I'm an old dude right now. I'm an old cat right now. But yo, don't try to make it look like you are. Listen, let's just all do the work. I apologize to everybody. But let's just do all the work without all the extra shade. Right? That's all. Peace.
And that was a fire ending. I need to hold on. Let me see. I ain't got no more. Oh, I messed that up. I went to the Wu-Tang. That's how much fire that was. They gonna hit me though. Hey, peace to y'all. Thank you for tapping in and thanks to everybody. I'm gonna close down the stream. Peace. All right, let me see. I'm close down the Zoom and meet for all and thanks for Dr. Reggie and Shaka for putting this information up for us to overview, and Asar for doing this presentation, and Dr. Mari Obidi, and everybody involved. I had a phone call, so I missed a great portion of the show, but you know, I know my brothers are responsible in good information dissemination. I ain't got much more to say. I'm about to go handle a little business, and then I'm about to do my... play like an hour of my games.